Greetings and congratulations on your successful download of this podcast episode. Before we commence with the discussion, please be advised of the possibility that offensive material may be expressed by our hosts at any given moment. Rest assured that they are people of fine character who have yet to be charged with a particular crime and harbour no ill will toward anyone. However, they are rather forthright in their opinions and capable of unpleasant language that may upset those of you with obviously superior moral standards. We value your interest in this podcast and hope to prevent such disgusting, filthy words causing you and your loved ones to scream in absolute terror, resulting in years of considerably expensive psychiatric therapy. And now, on with the episode.
Hello again, everyone. Welcome back to the Drunk Cinema Theater. I'm Charles Skaggs, one of your co-hosts here for Drunk Cinema. And, of course, I'm joined by my wonderful co-host, wonderful friend, and wonderful drinking partner, the wonderful Xan Sprouse. How are you doing, Xan?
I'm great, Charles. How are you doing?
I'm doing pretty good. We just talked yesterday when we recorded Ghostwood, so I'm doing pretty good because I got to talk to you two nights in a row.
I know. This is not a bad arrangement. I like this.
Yeah, this is pretty good. So,
I bet you would get sick of me before I got sick of you, though.
We had this discussion yesterday, if you recall, and I said you would get far sick of me first.
Yeah, I don't know about that. I don't know if the week before Christmas we're going to have to put that to the test. But my money is on you getting sick of me first.
No. Just ask my wife. You'll get sick of me first. She'll back me up on this.
But she's got, like, what, 25 years in on this?
Yeah, but just ask anybody who knows me. How's that? All right. So here at episode 3, we're going to be talking, at long last, we've been waiting for this one, Die Hard.
Die Hard, yes. It's a week before Christmas, and all through the house, not a creature was stirring except the two assholes getting drunk and watching action movies.
So, needless to say,
yippee-ki-yay, motherfucker.
Yippee-ki-yay, motherfucker.
Enough. Sorry, I'm just quoting Die Hard now.
Okay, well, go ahead. That's why we're here. Go ahead and quote Die Hard.
I just said enough jokes. That's all I said.
So yes, this is the 1988 action film written by Jeb Stuart, presuming not the general, and Stephen E. D'Souza, directed by John McTiernan. Remember mm-hmm. him? He used to direct movies once upon a time.
He did.
Until he got himself in a little legal trouble. No big deal, right?
Well, you know.
It happens. But McTiernan goes on, of course, to direct the third film, Die Hard with a Vengeance, with Samuel L. Jackson. And he also directed the movie Predator, The Hunt for Red October, and the 1999 version of The Thomas Crown Affair with Pierce Brosnan.
I completely forgot that was even a thing.
Yeah, we've got that movie, so that's how I knew about it. Lori liked it a lot. Rene Russo's in it, too, so pretty good.
It's Pierce Brosnan. It's going to be entertaining.
It was pretty solid. So, yeah. Brosnan had a good decade with the 90s, let's just say.
He did, yeah.
And this was produced by Lawrence Gordon and Joel Silver, you know, one of those Hollywood producers.
Joel Silver.
Yeah, who produces a lot of big-budget blockbuster movies back in the day.
Yep. Yeah, he was the, you know, Jerry Bruckheimer of his day.
Pretty much. And, yep. Of course, this stars Bruce Willis's John McClane. And, of course, you know, Xan and I are both Moonlighting fans, so that's where we knew him first.
Right, and this movie, when it came out. By the way, Charles, do you want to know what grade I was in school when this movie came out?
No.
You don't? Okay.
No, go ahead. I'm just seeing.
I was in junior high, dickhead!
I had a feeling that was coming.
You knew that was coming. Right?
You set it up perfectly, yes.
Yeah. So in 1988, when this came out, we knew Bruce Willis pretty much from Moonlighting and Seagram's commercials.
Right, yeah.
Seagram's Golden Wine Cooler commercials, which I just had this discussion on Facebook with my friend Tom the other day. Mm-hmm. And he said he was thinking about the Seagram's Golden Wine Cooler theme, like the jingle.
Oh, yeah.
And it just all came back to me. I remembered all of it and how it went. And it's on YouTube, so I'll post a link to it to our Drunk Cinema page.
Yeah, please do. I haven't seen those in forever.
That's all we knew. Well, and he was on the radio with his cover of Respect Yourself.
Oh, that's right. Yeah.
Singers.
Yeah, because obviously being on Moonlighting, he became very famous as David Addison.
Very fast, yeah. He was that show was, you know, meteoric rise to extremely popular. It's fantastic. Romantic comedy / detective story /
Fourth wall breaking,
you know, will they or won't they type of situation. It was a fantastic show. Fantastic theme song by the late Al Jarreau.
Yep. Sybil Shepherd, produced by mm-hmm. Glenn Gordon Caron, if I recall correctly.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Just a wonderful. Elise Beasley, Curtis Armstrong.
Yeah, exactly. And if you want to know more about Moonlighting.
Yes, I would like to know more.
You should check out the Moonlighting book written by our friend Scott Ryan.
There you go. Perfect.
I will post a link to that on our page as well.
I need to get a copy of that.
I know. I don't have one yet. I keep thinking, oh, you know what? Next time I do an order, I'm going to order something. And I just...
Maybe you should send us one since we, you know, keep plugging it on our show.
Well, he sent me The Last Days of Letterman, so I think I'm due to freaking buy something from him.
Okay, that makes fair. Well, you gotta keep him going, right? That's only fair, okay. Right?
And our friend Mike McGreener put out a Christmas song this week, which is lovely and heartbreaking.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Yeah, he did. He sent it to me last week, and it's so amazing and so heartbreaking. I love it. He put it out on his Facebook today, I think, or sometime this week. But yeah, he did a Christmas song, and it's lovely. So all of our friends are creating things, and
which is wonderful.
You know, it's Christmas.
Yep.
Which is so good for that. Yeah.
And we're creating podcasts, so. So yeah, this is essentially our Christmas episode. In addition, of course, to Bruce Willis, we had the late great Alan Rickman as Hans Gruber,
mm-hmm.
best known to Harry Potter fans, of course, as Professor Snape, but has been in so many other different things. He was the Sheriff of Nottingham in Robin Hood, Prince of Thieves.
Yep.
And of course, he's in Galaxy Quest.
Oh, by Grabthar's hammer.
Yeah, by Grabthar's hammer.
What a savings. Alan Rickman plays one of my favorite characters in the Emma Thompson film adaptation of Sense and Sensibility.
Yeah, Laurie loves that version.
Yeah, Colonel Christopher Brandon, who is truly the best of men, as they say in that story. And it is very true. He's a wonderful character. So yeah. I love Alan Rickman.
Yeah, we lost a big talent when he passed.
We lost a really big talent when we lost him. It was very sad.
We have Bonnie Bedelia's Holly Gennero / McClane. Take a mm-hmm. pick in this movie. Reginald VelJohnson as Sergeant Al Powell.
Yep.
Best known for those Family Matters. Episodes,
yep.
Right? Back in the 80s. Yep.
The series, yeah, the Miller Boyette cavalcade of ABC crap that went through the 90s and 80s. I mean, Miller Boyette, the producers were responsible for... Bosom Buddies as well.
Oh, really? So, yeah. That introduced Tom Hanks to the world.
Yeah, pretty much. They were Bosom
And forgot
buddies,
about
and
Peter Scolari in the process.
Oh, Peter Scolari had that second career with Newhart.
Yeah.
But I think Miller and Boyette were also responsible for Perfect Strangers and, of course, Full House, you know, the perennial favorite of the late 80s, early
90s. The TGIF shows.
The TGIF, yeah, exactly. So, yeah. We have Miller Boyette to thank for, I forget what their first names are. They're two guys. I think it's Thomas Miller, but I don't remember the other guy's first name. But
yeah
they are they're responsible for the TGIF nights in the early 90s.
We had Devereaux White as Argyle.
As Argyle, yes.
Who recently returned in that Die Hard Battery commercial with Bruce Willis.
The Die Hard Battery commercial, yeah.
And also with Clarence Gilliard as Theo, making his return.
Theo was there too. Yeah, that was a fantastic commercial. Yeah, Devereaux White started his career very early. He was in the Blues Brothers.
Oh, really? What did he play?
He's the little kid that tries to steal a guitar off the wall.
Oh, from Ray's Music Shop?
Ray's Music Exchange, yes.
Yeah, that's it.
And Ray Charles shoots at him?
Yeah.
That's Argyle as a little boy.
Interesting.
Yep.
I did not know. That's a great bit of trivia. I like that.
Thanks.
And then we've, of course, had the ever skeevy, hateful William Atherton as...
Oh, has he ever been a nice guy?
Richard Dick Thornburg. And, of course, known to Ghostbusters fans and Real Genius fans.
Well, you can believe Mr. Pecker. My name is Peck.
Yes, it's true. This man has no dick.
Has no dick. Ghostbusters, Real Genius. He's never nice. He's never a good guy. He spent the 80s being the comedic villain.
Right. Yeah. Alexander Goodenough as Carl.
Hell yeah, Alexander Goodenough. The late, great Alexander Goodenough, who is an action star and a ballet dancer, ladies.
Take that, Mikhail Baryshnikov.
He's freaking amazing in this, too.
Yeah.
And... yeah, he's very sexy. He's also
he's all bloody coming out at the end, ready to take that final shot.
He's a little bit sexy because his shirt's kind of open. But you know, I don't like the bloody gore that he's got going on. But
okay. All right.
Yeah, people who are not fans of the ballet might also recognize him from the Money Pit,
right?
With Tom Hanks and Shelley Long.
All roads lead to Tom Hanks, don't they?
All roads lead to, in the 80s, it's like either Tom Hanks or Dabney Coleman.
This is true.
Yeah.
Hart Bochner as Harry Ellis.
Hart Bochner. Yes, Hart Bochner. I think we talked about this already, Charles. Do you remember the episode of The Twilight Zone with the aliens that come down with the cookbook?
Yes, I do. To Serve Man. Yes.
Yes. That stars Lloyd Bochner, who is Hart Bochner's father.
And I remember you telling me this for the first time, and I was just blown away by that.
Hart Bochner, and Hart Bochner also directed one of my favorite 90s comedies, which is PCU,
yes.
with Jeremy Piven and David Spade.
Which I still have not seen, but...
it's lovely.
Yeah. Apparently that's one of the things I need to get on and do that.
That's a good one. And wasn't he a voice in Batman the Animated Series?
I'm not sure. I didn't do like, you know, the big IMDb on Hart Bochner, so.
There's more to Hart Bochner than meets the eye.
He could have been. They got a lot of great, weird, interesting actors for that show.
Well, you keep going down the list, Charles, and I'm going to look up Hart
Bochner. Yeah, go ahead and do that. So we have James Shigeta as Joseph Yoshinobu Takagi, who sadly meets his end early on in this episode.
Of five.
Yes. Robert Davi as Special Agent Big Johnson.
No, the other one.
Yes, no, the other one. He's the one that went to Vietnam.
Mm-hmm.
And he's best known to James Bond fans because he played Sanchez in License to Kill.
To Kill.
The second Timothy Dalton movie.
Which is my favorite of the two Timothy Dalton movies.
See, I prefer Living Daylight, so I'm Living Daylight's guy.
I really like the Carrie Lowell character.
She's good. She's one of the better. She's like one of the first modern Bond girls because she's actually...
she's sexy and she's smart and she's not like overly made up. I just think she's great. Yeah, he plays
she's
Arthur
not a pushover.
Reeves in Mask. Yeah, he's Arthur Reeves in Mask of the Phantasm.
Really? That's interesting.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I was needing to watch that again anyway because
they
just, DC Comics just made the Phantasm continuity.
Oh, that's right.
Yeah. So Andrea Beaumont is... yeah, canon now. So I was in the mood to watch
Bochner,
that again.
Yeah, Hart Bochner's in Mask of the Phantasm.
And let's see who else. We have Grand L. Bush as Special Agent Little Johnson.
Who was also in Junior High.
And Paul Gleason, whom you may remember from The Breakfast Club.
You're going to knock your dick in the dirt.
As LAPD Deputy Chief Dwayne T. Robinson.
From up here, it doesn't look like he's in charge of jack shit, Dwayne.
We're going to need some more FBI guys.
Do you want a breath mint?
So needless to say, we're very eager to do quote this movie, and we haven't even started yet. So this is 2 hours, 12 minutes. This movie actually got 4 Academy Award nominations, believe it or not.
Yeah, it did.
Yeah, but unfortunately, it was all like technicals.
Well, you know.
But you got to start somewhere. At least it got more than Ferris Bueller got.
Well, which was nothing.
Yeah, which was Zippo. Yeah, exactly.
Yeah,
a Golden Globe. That's what Academy Award nomination it got. So it was nominated for Best Film Editing, Best Visual Effects, Best Sound Effects Editing. All three of those were won by Who Framed Roger Rabbit.
Makes perfect sense.
And Best Sound, but that lost to the biographical film Bird, which I don't remember.
Bird?
I think it was based on the jazz musician, if I'm not mistaken.
I'm sure it was, but I don't, who was in that? I wonder. I don't remember that being a thing either.
Yeah, well, apparently that's what happened.
Okay.
Score, of course, by Michael Kamen, who also went on to do the next two Die Hard movies. X-Men, mm-hmm. License to Kill. So we got two License to Kill connections here. Yep. The Lethal Weapon series and Robin Hood, Prince of Thieves.
Yeah, Michael Kamen's been around. He's done some good stuff.
Yes, he did. So what I'm drinking, by the way, before we get started, is a Yuengling lager tonight.
All right.
And what is Xan? What are you drinking?
I have a...
It's a Yuengling traditional,
Market Garden,
by the way.
Gotcha. Market Garden Brewery Festivus Holiday Ale.
Festivus for the rest of us.
It's Festivus for the rest of us, yes. So while, you know, as I prepare for the airing of the grievances, I figured this would be good. It's very nice. It's very spicy.
Yeah.
But not too spicy. I have a selection of holiday themed and winter themed beers that I just picked up to try. And so before we, got really into this, Charles, I was drinking a, Shiner Sheer, which is not just my favorite Christmas beer. It's literally my favorite beer
ever.
So I get very, yeah.
Really?
I get very excited at Christmas time when it's time for Shiner Sheer. So I've had a Shiner Cheer, and I have had a Market Garden Festivus.
Excellent.
And it's almost gone. So we should probably start watching this movie.
Yeah, quickly. We probably should. So, well, you're still able to be coherent. So, all right. So, everybody, if you're watching along with us, and we hope you do, we are just past the 20th Century Fox opening.
The black screen of blackness is now dark.
Just right after the moment where you see the 20th Century Fox logo, and then you start in your head going... A long time ago in a galaxy far, far away. Dot dot dot.
Because this is another one of the movies that actually does the full fanfare.
Yes.
So the thing is, Charles, when I saw Star Wars, I knew the 20th Century Fox fanfare. But I think it's because of either the soundtrack or the story of Star Wars. I don't remember which one. But because I heard that so often, if I hear the full 20th Century Fox fanfare, it just sounds like it's going to be the Star Wars.
Yeah, theme. That's my default setting as well.
No matter how many times I hear the whole thing, it's Star Wars.
No matter what movie I'm watching, if I hear that Fox fanfare, it's Star Wars. It's like I keep expecting Star Wars.
Oh yeah, for sure.
Yeah. So 20 seconds in, black screen of blackness, mm-hmm. and if everybody's ready, we will. I'm going to press, count us down 3, 2, 1, and then we'll press play. That's easy for me to say together.
Yeah. Well, before you do that, Charles, let's do our disclaimer.
Okay.
That, Charles and I are at home. We are not, anywhere that we would need to drive or operate heavy machinery. Our spouses are home with us. So if we need medical attention, we can easily get it. So, cause, you know, don't drink in movie. Lightly. Do it responsibly, kids.
Exactly. So, yeah, watch movies with us responsibly and you know, doing the safety of your own home. Don't go out driving. We definitely don't recommend that. And because we want you to be around to listen to further episodes of Drunk Cinema. So we care about you.
And, you know, when we finally get a chance to be together again, if you do decide to drink in movie together, make sure that you're somewhere where you have a spare couch for your friend to stay.
Exactly.
So, yeah.
And of course, I'm going to be the designated podcaster since I'm just doing a lager here.
Yeah. Because Charles gets way less drunk than I do. So.
Somebody's got to steer this ship into the iceberg. Come on.
Oh, if this is 1988, we should make an Xan Valdez joke.
Well, that's kind of interesting that you
look it up, kid. Yep. Somebody from Exxon got fired.
Yeah, needless to say, yeah, it was a slightly inebriated sea captain that
slightly inebriated that pretty much ruined the ecosystem of Alaska for the next 300 years.
Yeah, no big deal, right?
No big thing.
You know, Exxon ruined the ecosystem before BP oil ruined the ecosystem.
They're the OGs of
ruining the ecosystem. They get it done, right? All right, so if everybody's ready, we are going to do this in 3, 2, 1, doink.
Bloop. Gordon Company Silver Pictures presents. I gotta say, Charles, I have one complaint about the Roku remote.
Yeah, what is it?
The way I hold the remote?
Yeah.
My thumb hits the mute button, like, all the time.
Mine, too. Yeah, that happens to me, too. Yeah. What I do is I put the remote out of reach, so I don't keep doing that.
Yeah. Yeah, I gotta do that. All right, you guys. I've got a decent amount of air travel in my time.
Mm-hmm.
And a few years ago, my friend Chris McMillan did a show in Bangor, Maine that he invited us to, which was an amazing show. We would love to go back when we can have shows again.
Yeah.
But we ran into some really bad turbulence, and we had to land in New Hampshire and spend the night because the storms were too bad. We were fine above the storm, but we couldn't get through the storm to land. It was too choppy. And I actually got airsick. I threw up. It was terrible. And I got into the hotel room and I made fists with my toes.
Yeah.
It did not work.
It didn't? So no. So what you're saying is Die Hard lied to you.
It doesn't. I just think that this guy, yeah, he's got, you know, he's got more going on with his feet than I do, I guess.
It does feel relaxing.
It's relaxing, but it doesn't like necessarily help you all that much when it comes to relieving any nausea or Die Hard.
Yes.
Yeah. Oh, geez.
That's a big bear.
Back when suitcases were made out of tweed and only some of them had wheels on them.
Right.
This is weird, Charles. Didn't we talk last night about suitcases with wheels, whether or not they have them?
No, we didn't. I don't believe we did. If we did, I don't remember.
I like to think that that little report to the white courtesy phone thing, I like to think that that's a nod to Airplane.
The white courtesy phone is for, yes.
No, the white phone. The Mayo Clinic is on the white phone. Yes, Nakatomi Building.
Now, I have been, you know, worked for corporations since 1992. Uh-huh. And none of them have had a Christmas party this decked out.
No.
So apparently I'm not working for the right company, apparently.
This, I think, was a thing that sort of went away in the 90s because, you know, these are catered and open bar and stuff like that. They're a major expenditure.
Well, not only that, they're now a big, huge HR nightmare because of guys like Ellis.
We'll see a little bit later.
Who like has sex with women in his office and then does cocaine and
he's not the one having sex in the office. That's not Ellis.
I thought that was Ellis as well.
No. Ellis is just doing the cocaine on her desk.
Oh, okay, got it.
Yeah, yeah, it's her desk. So, but yeah, she's rapidly climbing the
corporate ladder
here, and that baby's ready to tend bar. Yeah,
it's Lucy McClane, first appearance.
Lucy McClane speaking. Yes, Lucy McClane, who comes back in Die Hard 4.
Yep, Live Free or Die Hard. Yep.
Yeah, Die Hard 4.
Played by what's her name?
It's a girl, isn't it?
No, I'm trying to move.
Isn't it this kid grown up?
I don't think so.
Okay, I don't know.
I think it's because I think they recast it.
Did they?
Yeah.
We'll see what Santa and Mommy can do, okay? Let's make things confusing for the kids. I don't know, though. John McClane is kind of an ass, though. With his whole, like...
he is. Well, but that's kind of the thing. Mary Elizabeth Winstead.
Why do you need to have a job?
It's Mary Elizabeth Winstead. That's who I was thinking of.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
Yeah. Which I should have remembered because she was in Scott Pilgrim versus the World. And also recently Birds of Prey.
Wasn't she in The Thing also?
As Huntress, I believe.
The prequel to The Thing?
No, I think so. Maybe.
Yeah, I think so.
I didn't see that one, so...
A lot of people didn't like, but I really liked it because it did a good homage to
yeah,
to the original well, not the original, but the John Carpenter.
I was going to say, not the 1954 version or whatever it is.
No.
Yep.
Fucking California. I mean, now most people...
J. McClane.
Most people go to the airport in their Lululemon pants now. So that's not anything new.
McClane, Argyle McClane. One day, you guys will be selling batteries together.
And it'll be glorious.
It will be.
Yeah.
And I'm sure Argyle was just waiting by the phone.
I've never had to do air travel around Christmas time. I think it would be a friggin' nightmare. I can't even imagine.
Yeah.
Look at all this outdated technology we have.
I know, right?
CB, VHS.
What, no Betamax in there?
No. This is 88. By that point, VHS had taken over Betamax. So, hey, Charles, have you ever read this book?
No, I haven't. Are you talking about Nothing Lasts Forever?
Yeah.
So for those who don't know, Die Hard was based on a 1978 novel, Nothing Lasts Forever, written by a former police officer, Roderick Thorpe.
Mm-hmm.
And the novel is just slightly different from the movie. Because
it's pretty different.
it's pretty different because, the detective is retired. And
he doesn't make it out at the end, does he?
No, he doesn't. His name is Joe Leland in the book. And apparently he's visiting the office headquarters of the Claxon Oil Corporation, where his daughter, Stephanie Leland Gennero, works. So essentially he's visiting his daughter, not his ex-wife.
Or his estranged wife.
Oh,
Jan DeBont, everybody. Director of photography, Jan DeBont.
We got some Run DMC coming up.
Jan DeBont, famous for Twister. For those of you who would like to have this song, it is on one of the very special Christmas compilations, which was put out in the 80s and 90s with covers painted by Keith Haring.
Yep.
And the proceeds of them went to AIDS research.
Yeah.
So they were an excellent purchase, and I have all of them.
Well, I have it on a 80s Christmas album that I picked up from Target. They were doing these, greatest hits type collections.
Yep.
And they did one with an 80s Christmas music. So that's why I snagged it.
Run DMC, rest in peace, Jam Master Jay.
Mm-hmm.
So I did I went with Chris to a convention in Chicago.
Mm-hmm.
And the hardest working man in comics, Victor Dandridge, was there also. Okay. A Columbus artist, good friend of ours. And I went over to talk to him at his table. And sitting next to him was Daryl McDaniels, who is the DMC of Run DMC.
Oh, that's awesome.
Who wrote a comic book. And I looked at Victor and I was like, oh my God, oh my God, oh my God, he's right there, he's right. Oh my God, he's sitting next to you. He's like, yeah, how do you think I felt all weekend?
Right.
we were both totally geeking out. I'm like, oh my God, you're sitting next to DMC. What do we say? What do we say? And then so Victor and I kept talking, and then there was a girl walked up behind me, and she just, behind the table, and I just hear her yell, oh my God, it's DMC.
I got to give points to Nakatomi Plaza for having touchscreen technology back then.
Okay, this pisses me off, though.
Yeah.
Because he says, yeah, I'm looking for Holly McClane. And the guy's like, just type it in there. So he types it in here. Okay, we figure out that she's not going by McClane. She's going by Gennero.
Yeah, which obviously burns McClane's ass big time.
Because he's a patriarchal misogynist. So he says, that's where they are. And the security guy says, oh, yeah, they're the only ones left in the building. Well, why did you make me type it in, shithead?
Yeah, yeah.
Why couldn't you just tell me if she's here, she's on the 30th floor? It's ridiculous.
Well, let's just face it. The security in this place is not very good.
Well, it's Christmas Eve.
Yep.
For Christ's sake, Powell, it's Christmas Eve.
Everybody phones it in at this point. They're off on their vacations.
And, you know, you got to feel bad for these guys. They're going to die tonight. So.
Spoilers, right?
Yeah. By the way, get used to that.
Spoilers.
Get used to that elevator dinging because
ding.
We hear it a lot.
And one great moment.
So now Argyle is going to park in the garage and give John about 30 minutes to see if he makes a good... Okay, those two people that just walked by, they're the ones that have sex.
Right. Oh, okay.
Yeah. Oh, God. Ellis is a is an HR nightmare regardless.
Oh, yeah, definitely.
Yeah.
Because he's that one guy in the office that everybody knows about.
And not only...
And probably all the women talk about in the restroom.
Not only is he a lech, he's a racist too, which we'll find out later on.
This is true.
And he literally does cocaine at work. So he's so John McClane apparently does not like his cosmopolitan, it looks like. I don't even know what that drink was, but it was,
I don't either.
Yeah. So
fucking California.
Okay, she looks like the scientist from one of the scientists from RoboCop with those big glasses on.
Yeah. Always liked that look, by the way.
California. What, the big glasses?
Yeah.
Yeah. Holly Gennero. Oh, man.
Poor Takagi.
I know. I feel bad for Takagi and his five kids.
Yeah.
Yeah. But the 80s.
Yep. It's the 80s. Everybody was doing cocaine. So,
the 80s were the decade of the shiny suit.
Ellis, yeah. You got a little something on your nose there.
You missed some.
Yeah, missed a spot.
I was just making a call. This is the nearest phone because it's the 80s and I don't have a cell phone.
Right. Or if I do, it's there a brick phone.
It's like I carry it like a satchel.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
I have to carry it in like one of those old Red Ryder wagons because it's so
big. Uh-huh, exactly.
I drag it behind me.
I love Ellis's like laugh at the boss's jokes.
Yeah. The fake laugh. Yeah.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
He's such a dick.
Yeah. I love his work laugh.
Yeah. There they are.
It's due to Holly. Am I right, JoJo? God.
Hi, John.
Oh, I was hoping you made that flight. H.M. Gennero, the director of corporate affairs. She's got her own office.
Right. Nice view of the city.
Nice view.
Yeah, she's doing good.
She's got that assistant who seems like a really nice lady.
Well, Takagi trusts her. He seems to think very highly of her.
I don't know why he doesn't just move out to Los Angeles. I mean, they could use more racist cops. It's a Rolex. Yeah, whatever, Ellis. He's so status conscious. Hey, Charles, do you watch Futurama?
Yes, I do. Avidly.
Well, do you remember the episode where they found another guy who had been frozen from the 80s, but the reason they froze him was so he could wake up when they finally found a cure for his bonitis?
Yeah.
Well, anytime Chris and I watch a movie or see somebody that is like an 80s douchebag, our code is that guy has bonitis. All right. So I have now gone to Victory Merry Monkey.
Okay.
This is a Belgian-style ale with ale with cranberry, orange peel, cinnamon, and nutmeg.
That sounds nice.
Merry Christmas to me.
So, right off the bat here, we have a reason for why John spends most of this movie in his tank top t-shirt. His wife beater shirt.
Yeah, he's like kind of cleaning up after the flight in her private bathroom.
And remember, he took his shoes off because he's going to try to relax a little bit.
And let's remember that at the beginning of this movie, this wife beater is white.
Exactly. It does not stay white for very long.
It does not stay white through this entire movie. All right, let's try this monkey here.
Oh, sorry. We were just going to come in here and have sex. No big deal.
Ooh, this is lovely.
Is it good? Sounded good.
Yeah. Yeah, it's good. I missed you. Yeah, but you didn't miss my name, though, did you? Because I'm a misogynist douchebag who thinks that my wife should just be my property. Even though she's probably making, like, four times as much money as he makes.
It's interesting that Bruce Willis filmed this between seasons of Moonlighting.
I know, right? Because it's quite a, as we see later, it's quite a physical...
Yeah.
Quite a physical feat for John McClane. All right, I am three beers in, Charles, so I need to take a few munches of food. Because
please do. Yeah, we know what happens when... We want you to make it through all the way through the movie. Yes.
We will be safely here, so yes. Give me a few minutes here.
We're having a very awkward conversation here. Yeah. Leave.
Oh, yeah. Get the hell out.
Go let that baby tend bar.
Yeah, seriously. Pour us a couple of...
Yeah, we'll take one. We need refills.
Gin and tonic.
We need refills. I'll take a I'll take a screwdriver. Thank you.
There you go.
I always like screwdrivers. Sonic or otherwise.
Let's see what you did there.
Thank you. Pacific Courier.
Oh, yeah.
I'm sure this won't be at all trouble.
No, this is fine.
This is fine. This is the dog sitting in the room on fire. This is fine.
This is fine. So, no, like we saw, Argyle is in the garage waiting for John McClane.
Right. Essentially to see if he's going to be going home with Holly or not.
Right, exactly. So what's going to happen here is when we start locking up the building, Argyle's going to get locked inside.
Yeah, when Nakatomi goes on full lockdown.
There is Alexander Gudinov, all 6'3" of him. My God, he's gorgeous.
Theo!
Is it time for... It's Christmas, Theo.
It's Christmas! Yeah. Doosh.
See, why do they have to kill these guys on Christmas? Why can't they just...
Theo's very physical.
Like, kick him out or something. I feel bad for these dudes.
Right.
They're just trying to... They're just trying to do their last shift before they go home for Christmas.
Right. It's bad enough they had to work this close to the holiday. Then they get killed in the process.
Yeah.
Hockey puck? What the?
Yeah, how did this work? Is that from the, Kings? Yeah, this poor guy.
There he is, Hans Gruber.
Vigo the Carpathian, everybody.
Is Vigo. You're like the buzzing of flies to him.
Flies to him. Yes, here in this in his gang of cronies, we have Vigo the Carpathian from Ghostbusters 2 and Genghis Khan from Bill and Ted's Excellent Adventure.
See, they're doing all this stuff, and meanwhile, I was on my Commodore 64 back in the day.
Yeah. Yeah, his name is, I want to say it's Al Young, or it's Al something. I forget exactly what it is, but whenever I see him, mm-hmm. he's one of those who go, oh, hey, look, Genghis Khan is in this. Because there are those actors that just, the first time I ever saw them, they made such an impression on me that just for the rest of my life, I just refer to them as that character.
Everybody does it. That guy.
Al is one of those for me. Yeah, he's just always going to be Genghis Khan.
Al Genghis Khan.
Mm-hmm. Ladies and gentlemen. All right, I'm getting a little early for myself, but these guys are like perfect Euro trash. I love it. Except for Huey Lewis right here.
Yeah, he pretty much does look like Huey Lewis, doesn't he?
He's very Huey Lewis.
Do you believe in love?
Do you? Because you're making me believe it too. I was walking.
See, left. I love that he's doing it in German. So he's like, links, Rex.
He's obviously, he's very, I think he's very OCD. Yeah. This looks like fun right there.
And this is one of the things that, this is one of the things I really enjoy about McTiernan movies, like Hunt for October and this movie, is that he's really good at having the camera follow around the action.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
There's McClane with the toes. It's like, okay,
I'm a little behind. Yeah. I'm like about a second behind you. Huh. But there's two things that date this movie, Charles.
Well, here, do you want me to pause for a second and then catch up?
Yeah, let's see. Where? Okay. Yeah, I've got him. Let me see. What do I got? I'm going to think of a good place to go for it. All right, you tell me. You pause and you tell me where you are, and then I'll catch up to you.
Well, here, I'll just pause for a second, and then you can. Okay. We'll see where we are. Well, okay, hold on. Pausing now.
All right. So okay. John is now dialing the phone.
Yes.
Okay.
He's talking to Argyle right now. Argyle just picked up.
Yeah, he's talking to Argyle, and okay. Argyle's in the limo with the bear.
Okay, I think we're good now.
We're good.
Okay.
So there's two things that.
Sorry
this
if we screwed you
girls.
Up, everybody.
You know this. We have to do this remotely, kids.
I know.
99.
He's like, "Fuck it! I'm just gonna chainsaw this motherfucker."
Yeah. I love how. What the hell is Carl's brother's name anyway? I can't even think of it right now.
Oh, I can't remember either.
Yeah.
But you can tell they're brothers because they're doing, like, they're pissing each other off.
They're pissing each other off, yeah. He's obviously very OCD and he wants to do things the way he likes to do them.
Yep.
But he, I have a blocks figure of him. Like one of those little brick figures.
Yeah, I don't know what you're talking about.
Yeah, and it's him, and he's got a X's on his eyes, a Santa hat. He's in an office chair, and it says, "Now I have a machine gun, ho ho ho."
Oh, yes,
that's awesome.
That is cool.
So,
I was wondering. Okay, I think that's out in a Funko, if I'm not mistaken.
No, mine's one of the little ones, one of the little brick ones.
I know what you're talking about, but I'm saying I think they also have it as a Funko.
If they're going to do any diehard Funkos, that's what it should be. Frankly.
Okay, so everybody, if you, I know you've seen this movie like 1,000 times, but yeah. So he's only in a tank top t-shirt. He's not wearing shoes or socks.
Right. Because he's been in the bathroom this whole time.
And all he has is his handgun.
Right. And Vigo the Carpathian is coming looking for everybody.
And here's our gratuitous boob shot.
Yeah, and here's our people that are having sex. It's not Ellis.
You're right. I stand corrected.
No, huh?
It just seemed like something Ellis would do, but...
Not anymore.
Not anymore. Well, that's true. Nice. Zing. Like Excellent.
So, yeah, the two things that date this movie, Charles, are the fact that they have to...
The two things?
Two things, yeah.
Okay.
Because this movie could happen... The one thing here that they would have to do is they would have to search everybody for cell phones. Right. Because I'm sure an office building like this would have landlines.
Not to mention much better camera security.
Right, they'd have better camera security, but they would have landlines for sure. So I'm sure they would still have to cut the landline. But there would have to be an extra scene where they pat everybody down and take all their cell phones from them.
Oh, yeah. And then we're also establishing here that the upper levels have not been finished yet.
They are not finished, yes.
So, therefore, there's lots of nasty construction going on that could injure people.
Right, that could injure people. So, he has no access to a phone. And no matter where he is on the floor, because they've cut through all the phone lines. So,
everybody chill the fuck out. It's good.
Yeah. But the other thing that they can't, I don't know how they would do it if they were going to make this movie today. Mm-hmm. Bearer bonds are now illegal.
Right.
Yeah, we don't have bearer bonds anymore. Because bearer bonds are literally what they sound like. that they belong to whoever is literally holding them right now.
Yes.
They're not issued to somebody's name. Like, Charles, if you had bearer bonds in your house and I took them, they're mine now.
Yeah.
Because there's no way to prove that they were yours.
Well, that's kind of what happens here, is that they're after the bearer bonds.
They're after the bearer bonds,
And for the same reason that, they're just going to take them. It's like having dollar bills, almost.
It's essentially like having dollar bills that don't, that can't be traced, things like that. Because once bearer bonds are sold, there's no tracing them, there's no tracking them. They're saying, hey, bearer bond number 8479132 was mine. I need to have it back. Whoever's literally holding a bearer bond is who owns the bearer bonds. Ellis.
Yeah, I know.
Such an ass.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, but because of shit like this,
right?
You know, people, you know, bearer bonds came to popularity in the Old West. People get shot for them. So,
let's just be glad that nobody has tried to update this movie.
Yeah, I'm just glad
because I don't think any of us want an update. It's a perfect
movie. And, you know,
movie.
as good as Bruce Willis is, mm-hmm. I didn't even see his version of Death Wish. I mean, I love the original Death Wish so much.
Yeah.
But I didn't even bother.
I saw enough of it. The trailer gave away so much of the damn movie, I didn't feel like I had to watch that one.
I was like, I don't know. Death Wish is a tough movie to watch, man. Mm-hmm. That rape scene is just...
brutal.
It is... Oh, it's brutal. It's on par with The Accused. It's horrible. Mm. Nice suit. John Phillips.
I have two myself.
I have two myself. Yeah. Again, yeah. The shiny suit was a big thing in the 80s, especially, you know, John Phillips.
The shark skin suit, yes.
Yeah, the shark skin suit, yeah. Armani was a big thing in the 80s. And they were very shiny.
35th floor.
So yeah, he's
taking a look around.
Now, where is this from? It's Japanese.
How do you know? Because I bought it in Japan. Nicely done.
Thanks.
Very nicely done.
All roads lead back to other movies, Charles. This is the connective tissue of how my brain works.
If you notice, there's kind of a trend with the movies that we've selected so far, Batman, Ferris Bueller's Day Off, and now Die Hard, that they all kind of seem to like keep referencing, as we watch them, we keep referencing all these movies back and forth. It's this tapestry we've created.
Yeah. The tapestry of the way our crazy minds work.
Right.
I'm still actually, Charles, I have to say, I'm still really shocked about how the realization I came to when we did the Drunk Cinema with Ferris Bueller about how influential that movie was on me and my personality and my tastes.
Right. Yeah. We talked about, cause you were so influenced by Ferris's Bedroom for one.
Ferris's Bedroom, the music, the references, you know, my favorite hockey team.
The Flyers.
How much I love Chicago, all of that kind of stuff.
The Red Wings, I'm just teasing. I'm just teasing.
It's the Red Wings.
I know, I'm just teasing.
Don't mess with Mr. Hockey, all right?
All right.
Strap on your skates, Gordy, you're going in. Mr. Sakagi. You should have just told him the code, and then you would have gone home to your wife and your five children.
The $640 million.
$40 million.
$40 million
that you have locked in your vault. And the computer controls the vault. Now, see, this is the thing that I think...
What kind of terrorists are you?
Who said we were terrorists? That's the thing, is that back in the 80s...
Yeah.
We still had an East Germany.
Right.
You know, we
still had the Berlin Wall. Because the Berlin Wall doesn't go down until next year.
Next year, 1989, yeah.
I have a piece of it, by the way.
Do you really?
Yep.
How did you get that? Tell us that story, Charles.
I'll show you. So what happened was after the fall of the Berlin Wall, everybody was trying to market the hell out of this. And so they made, like, they were doing souvenirs, and they shipped them over here to make money, and they had vendors, like, you know, just on the college campuses. So I picked it up when I was at the University of Central Florida. Hold on. I got to show this to you.
I'm very excited to see this. This is very cool. I've never known anybody that has a piece of the Berlin Wall. Yeah. Berlin Wall, which was referred to as the Brandenburg Gate, came down in December of 1989.
Okay,
and it was essentially the end of communism in Europe.
So what I have here, I don't know if you can see what it says right there.
It's too blurry.
Oh, you can't.
I can see that there's writing.
Yeah, it says. Okay, so it says original piece of the Berlin Wall, and it gives the date November 9th, 1989, and we have a chunk of wall that's covered in graffiti.
That is the coolest thing I've ever seen.
Sweet.
That
huh?
is so cool, Charles. Yeah, that is amazing.
So yeah, I've had like that for like 30 years now. Sitting up
31.
Here collecting 31 collecting dust.
Yeah, November, 31 years. Yep.
So just thought I'd share that with the class.
So what's going on? They heard a noise. Because John McClane has been spying on them to try and figure out what they're up to.
See, there's all kinds of treasures around this place.
You can break the code.
Can't you?
You didn't bring me along for my charming personality.
Argyle.
Tell me you heard the shots.
I love it. Cut to Argyle, and he's just on the phone.
Mm-hmm. Of course I'm coming over later. Would I lie to you, baby?
Got the hip-hop going. It's good.
Yeah. This is a Stevie Wonder song, if memory serves. I don't have the sound up. I just have the captions on.
Right.
So.
I barely have the sound on.
These guys all have fantastic mullets.
Well, it was the late 80s, so. They were trendsetters because it didn't really click in until the early 90s over here in Ohio.
No. The European mullet was a huge thing in the 80s. Like, if you played soccer, this was your hair.
No, but my point is it didn't become mainstream over here in the States.
No, it did. It totally did. Like I said, with soccer players.
Oh, with soccer players, but
when I was growing up, like kids in junior high and high school, they had this hair because it was like soccer hair. It's funny when they talk about on MST3K when they talk about this being hockey hair. I always think of it as soccer. I think of it as soccer hair. So I find this interesting.
I love how he just prowls the room.
Yeah, I find this interesting that this company keeps all of its. You know, what looks like,
liquid assets.
Well, it looks like they have bearer bonds and a bunch of like Nazi artwork.
Well, you know, that artwork has to end up somewhere. So.
Yeah, exactly. Trust me.
They may be dead too, asshole.
Think, damn it, think.
I wish Maddie was here. She
know
what
She'd
to do.
She know what to do.
Do bears bear? Do bees bee?
We're going to do a fire alarm.
Call rescue 911.
Call Huey Lewis 911.
Because that's the power of love.
Do-do-do. Don't need money. Don't need fame. Just need explosives to ride this train. So, you know what I've never quite figured out, Charles?
What?
Which one of these guys actually is Heinrich? Is it that blonde guy that I said had a fantastic mullet? But no, I don't think it is because he's there when when they bomb the RV?
That's a good question.
I love that line. If you come to Pop, I'll kiss your fucking Dalmatian.
Isn't Heinrich what's-his-name's brother?
No. No, because the one guy
Carl's
comes in,
brother?
He's like, he's like, see if he's lying about Marco and find out who else is missing.
Okay.
And then he comes in, he's like, he wasn't lying about Marco, he's down on the street. And the other man was Heinrich, and his bag is missing. I don't actually know which one is Heinrich. I've never actually figured that out.
I don't think it matters. They're all Heinrich. We are all Heinrich.
Because that's the thing, especially a few of them that last to the end of this movie, you know. I know that Carl is
Good enough.
And Marco is a ha! No more table. That's Marco.
Okay.
And I don't remember what Vigo's name is, and I can't think of his name right now. The emergency has been called off. Oh, Charles, have I told you? Actually, I don't know if I've told you this. I may have told you this, but I'm gonna have to run downstairs and go grab something.
Uh-oh.
I'll be right back.
Don't worry, everybody. I'm still here watching the movie.
No, I have the wireless headphones on. That's why I bought the
But you can't see the movie.
I know what's happening. He's going to beat up this German guy. He's going to steal his shoes.
Yeah.
And then he's going to put him in the elevator.
McClane fix him out with a buzzsaw.
He's going to say, I'm not going to hurt you.
Yeah, much.
So, yeah.
That's what my captain keeps telling me.
Yeah, he won't hurt me. You're a policeman. There are rules.
Whee!
Yeah.
No, he doesn't want to play piggyback.
No, he's not. He's not into that. So.
Stop headbutting yourself. Stairwell fight. In color. And there's our first bit of blood on John McClane's shirt.
Yep, there it is. Because this guy just broke his neck.
He had a nice trip and had a pretty rough fall.
Yep. He will not be joining us for the rest of his life.
Very nice. Excellent.
See, that's the thing. When you quote Die Hard in your usual life, like all the time,
right?
It just comes so naturally.
It's all part of it's all part of your vernacular. Yes.
All right, Charles. Do you want to see something really cool?
Always. Nice. Where'd you get that?
This is a Die Hard prop.
That's actually a prop. That's awesome.
This is actually a machine gun.
Yeah.
That was used in Die Hard.
How the hell did you get that?
This is Chris's.
Okay, so now my piece of Berlin Wall, my little chunk of Berlin Wall is pretty lame in comparison.
No, your Berlin Wall is pretty damn cool. But this is the Die Hard gun.
Yeah.
We're not 100% sure if it's screen used or not, but I like to think it's Genghis Khan's gun.
Okay.
Personally, that's just my
yeah.
That's my personal fantasy. But yeah, this is our, it's ours now.
Yes.
Chris is when I met him. And, when I first met him, like the first time I came over to his house, he showed me this gun and I was like, I think I'm going to marry this boy.
Nice.
So, yeah.
Okay. See, this is what it takes, people. You know, you gotta step your game up.
Yeah, if you want to get the weirdo fat girl at the bookstore, you gotta have a Die Hard machine gun. But yeah, there used to be the prop collecting community used to be a lot less expensive, and there was a lot of bartering going on. So
yeah, but now they have all these like expensive auctions for everything.
Chris, I believe, got this by trading. Probably Legionnaires pages.
Okay. That makes sense.
For this? Yeah.
Probably a couple covers in there. Yeah.
Yeah, that's where this came from. Yeah, this is our
sweet.
This is our Die Hard gun.
Do you have a certificate to go with that?
Oh, hell no.
Okay. I didn't know.
Because like I said, it was back in the day of like...
Oh, here we go.
Ding.
Now I have a machine gun. Ho,
now, ho. Million terrorists in the world and I got to kill one with feet smaller than my sister.
Nice. You got to love the dialogue in this movie. It's fantastic.
Yeah. Now I have a machine gun.
I'm one of those people that just, if you have great dialogue in the movie, you know, you're halfway to, like, making me love this movie. It's important.
This movie is so perfect because it's, there's only a couple of stupid things in this movie. Like I said, I really don't like the guy at the beginning saying, type the name in. Oh, yeah, they're the only ones left in the building. It's like, why'd you make me type the name in?
Right. See, like I never noticed said, that, but now I will notice that every single time I watch this movie after this. So thank you for that.
Yeah, they cut off the phones.
Yep.
We have to tell Carl that his brother is dead.
I love that he's keeping score of everybody by writing it on his arm with a marker.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. He knows.
He's trying to keep track of all the guys.
He knows names and numbers and things like that. So
showing is a little bit of his intelligence here.
He is a cop. He does do some detecting. So good for him. But, yeah. And like I said, the fact that these are bearer bonds
right. Makes
this an extremely believable possibility that these guys can steal all this shit. So, and this movie, in my opinion, Charles, is the barometer to which all other action movies are measured.
Oh, I totally agree.
Yeah. This
is the pinnacle of action movies as far as I'm concerned.
Yeah. I mean, if we're going to add a sci-fi element to it, then it's probably going to be Terminator 2.
I got to touch the boobs. Oh.
Girls.
Next time. That's right, because he comes through there again the second time, and that's what he does.
Yeah, he keeps
the Playboy calendar. Playboy.
Yep.
Carl is not happy.
No. Carl's very angry.
I want blood. It's like, what are you?
Let Hydra plant the detonators and then Theo prepare the vault. Until then, Wheatley, don't alter the plan.
Apparently, Carl always part Klingon.
Well, he wants the, you know, by Grabthar's hammer, you will be avenged. Yeah, exactly.
Like, Holly, why are you talking to Ellis?
Yeah. Ellis.
His job.
Jesus Christ, Ellis, these people are going to kill you.
And we're all going to laugh.
No, I don't know.
No, I can't because he's dead.
Yeah, he won't be joining us for the rest of his life.
For the rest of his life. Yeah, you gotta say exactly. It really slow. You gotta say it very slow, deliberately drawn out. Yes.
Yep.
It's a nice view.
Oh, geez.
Nice night in California.
Oh, my God. Yeah. There's no way California was this clear in 1988.
No. To be fair, it got worse, but yeah.
Yeah, that's true. The roof, go!
The roof, go! Yes. He figures it out.
Yeah.
This is a nice little battle of wits between these two.
Oh, yeah. I love the battle of wits between the two of them. I love him just catching that bag in midair. God, right. He's so sexy. I hope this stupid bitch gets fired.
She should, yeah. Yeah. Do it sound like I'm ordering a pizza?
Lady, do I sound like you order a pizza? Oh, I should have ordered a pizza. I was, you know, because sometimes I like to try and have food that relates to the movie I'm watching.
Right.
You know, which is why we find ourselves without donuts so many times.
Yes.
And I was thinking, like, they really don't eat anything in Die Hard except for Twinkies, and I don't want Twinkies. But yeah, I forgot about the ordering a pizza. Call 911 on your telephone.
Fine, report me. Like, fuck down here.
Just come the fuck down here and arrest me.
Wow, that almost sounds like gunfire.
Wow, yeah. Listen to how loud that was. See if there's a black and white that can do a drive-by.
Just wait for Lilu to come by and pick him up.
She has a multipass.
Multipass.
Yeah, she knows it's a multipass.
Multipass.
See, I don't want any Twinkies. Twinkies are gross. Like, I think.
Oh, they are they?
Oh, look at Charles.
I came prepared. So here's Sergeant Alpow, because this is everything the body needs.
I thought we only ate donuts on our podcast.
Excellent.
What the hell's in these things anyway?
Sugar, flour, cornstarch.
Okay, here, actually, yeah. Partially hydrogenated vegetable oil, everything a grown boy needs. Okay, here's another thing that dates this movie, Charles.
Yes. The ingredients list is much shorter back then.
No. Look at how much the gasoline costs.
Right. 74 cents.
77 fucking cents, man.
By the way, this Twinkie is excellent.
Did you notice that there's regular and unleaded gas?
Mm-hmm.
Not just, you know.
Well, they still have that.
It's not, because now, no, we don't have regular gas anymore. We don't have leaded gasoline anymore.
Oh, you mean regular, yeah. Well, see,
yeah,
what we have is unleaded regular.
Yeah, we have unleaded in various octanes, but it's not regular and unleaded. It's unleaded only. So, yeah, that dates this movie. I actually...
But it's, Charles, called, it's called regular.
It's called regular, but it's not what the regular was back then. Back then, regular and unleaded meant leaded and unleaded.
Right.
There was leaded gasoline. And Charles, I dated a guy in 1994 who drove a 1974 Volkswagen Beetle, I think it was.
Yep.
And its engine required leaded gasoline, so when he would fill up a tank, he had to put in a lead additive because there was no leaded gasoline anymore. So, yeah, that dates this movie a little tiny bit.
I'm going to have such a sugar rush right now.
You are going to have such a sugar junk
especially
food headache.
Especially after you eat the second Twinkie.
Oh, the second Twinkie. What about the second Twinkie?
That's a big Twinkie. That's what she said.
It doesn't matter how many times I see this movie, I get like sweaty palms watching him.
There he is, touches the boobs.
Yeah, girls.
Good luck. Yeah. It's good luck.
And you just want to say, it's like, dude, you guys are at work. Are the construction guys like jerking off at work or something? Like, what the?
No. This is just a guy thing. Trust me on this.
I don't get it. It's like.
See, I used to work for a service company that, that repaired restaurant kitchen equipment.
Oh, okay.
This kind of thing happens all the time.
Gotcha. Now, I will say, my friend Aaron and I, when we worked at the bookstore together, my friend Aaron mm-hmm. Fleming, who
right.
is the host of the true crime podcast, Red Rum Blonde,
mm-hmm.
We created what we called boy cups. Because we sold, at the store, we sold those mugs that you could like take apart and like put pictures in and then you'd have a mug.
Mm-hmm.
So we just like cut pictures out of all the old US weeklies of like, you know, Jude Law, Brad Pitt, all the guys that we liked.
All right.
So yeah, we made boy cups, but they were closed. I mean, we were at work. We wanted to be somewhat professional.
I understand that.
Yeah. That was the thing. Oh my gosh. And I'm going to tell you, Charles, this gun is
yes.
made out of, like, rubber.
So it would bend.
This would not hold anybody's weight. Yeah, it's like rubber and wire. Like,
well,
this
to
whole
be...
thing. This...
Yeah.
Yeah, it's that one's obviously metal.
Well, it would have to be, because otherwise it wouldn't support his weight. If that was actually him.
Yeah.
Because the shot of him going over the edge into the air vent would probably
yeah.
be like there's probably a floor right below him.
Mm-hmm.
For
oh
him
yeah,
to
this
stand
is a
on.
Matte painting. Yeah, this is a matte painting for sure. Oh my god.
Or there's probably at least a net or something.
Yeah. oh, this is the worst.
Yeah. And you got that little tension. Because it just barely fits in the edges of that vent hole, or that vent access.
Yeah, yeah. Oh, man, I got to keep
joking. Got to reach. Oh, there goes the strap.
Oh!
Nice save.
At least he caught one of those. And he's able to... See, now this is where not having shoes pays off, because
right. His
toes can kind of, like, grip...
Yeah.
On the sides.
Where's the lighter? Flick.
He's got to get the lighter out of his pocket.
I feel like a TV dinner. Yeah, oh, TV we'll get together. Like. Have a few laughs.
Yeah, it's coming to the coast.
Iconic line.
And now they know where he is. They know what floor he's on.
I feel like a TV Oops. Dinner.
TV dinners, kids, back in the day, used to be packaged in foil. They weren't packaged in plastic. And,
right. Not exactly convenient for the microwave. You got to heat them up
no.
in the oven. Right?
And, you know, frankly, they're better that way, but still.
Yeah.
But, yeah, you'd peel back the foil, and it was TV night on TV trays. It was lovely.
Then you played with your sticks and your rocks. We liked it.
And we liked it.
Whoa, whoa, whoa. Nice shooting, Tex.
The flowers are still standing.
Poink.
Yeah, let's see if he's...
Click. Slowly cock the gun.
He's like in a little bit of an echo chamber here. I feel like right. They would hear this. You know?
You would think, yes.
I know, right?
So close. He's almost there. The tension. It's nice lighting on that shot.
Oh, yeah.
With the light coming up through the vent.
We gotta go.
Makes everything look very tense. Damn, those Twinkies were good.
Reminds him that he's imprisoned in that ductwork.
Sergeant Al Powell's onto something, kids. I'm just saying.
Weather outside is frightful. Green on black computers, everybody. Welcome to the 80s. That's another thing. If they just cut the internet out.
Right.
I just said, you could do this today, but there's nothing to steal because there's no such thing as a bearer bond.
Right.
Oh, poor Takagi.
They would have to, they would have something like, oh, gee, Bitcoin.
Oh, dear God.
Yeah, right? This is why you cannot remake Die Hard ever.
No, exactly.
It'd be all cryptocurrencies or something.
Cryptocurrencies, yep. I mean, everything is trackable. I've said this before, Charles, that technology is made for people who are on the up and up. You know, there's no such thing as technology for...
the downwardly mobile.
Exactly. Yeah. Does anybody want a new drug?
Hi, Sergeant. Hi, Officer. It's hip to be square.
Evening, Officer. What can I do you for?
Do you know you kind of look like Buffalo Bill?
He kind of does.
Yeah, does he? That's a good point.
Yeah, he kind of does.
Put the lotion in the basket.
Hey, you don't know what pain is.
Come on, I got $50 riding these assholes.
God. What college game is playing on Christmas Eve?
Well, college teams traditionally do play on Christmas Eve.
I thought college was done by now.
These are like bowl games. These are college bowl games.
Oh, they're bowl games. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, that makes more sense.
Yeah. It's not regular season. It's postseason. These are bowl games.
Okay.
See, this is one of my skills is that I actually speak geek and I speak sports. So
well,
I'm bilingual that way.
you know, because, you know, well, being being an Ohio State
right.
town, Charles,
yes.
you know, we're just, I guess we're just so used to watching the Rose Bowl and the Fiesta Bowl that yeah. we don't watch it until January.
Right. Nice. Yes. I didn't know there were bowl games before January.
Yeah, what's why bother?
Right. What's the point? People really play
okay,
those?
So that guy, no. All right. So there's two guys with blonde mullets.
Yeah.
All right. So the guy in the white sweater that John McClane just shot, that's Heinrich.
Yeah. Hell with this.
Okay. Ah, hell with this.
Take that, table.
Yeah.
You know you're just wasting your ammo, right?
Ah! No more table.
Where are you going?
Ow.
Good advice. Okay, I think you got him.
Just unloaded the clip into him, dude.
Right.
Actually, the voice. Right into his junk. How did you get 3 seconds ahead of me? We're watching the same movie, and we're both on HBO Max. How did this happen?
I don't know.
Are you like
I watch faster than me? Yeah, it's what I am, kind of timey-wimey, so it's kind of my thing.
Are you just more efficient at watching movies?
I am. I do it much faster. Yes.
Yeah. That's a wild goose chase down here at Nakatomi Plaza. Living here is okay.
Yeah,
you look
snow,
like
let's
hallway.
Snow.
Let it snow, let it whack.
It'd be raining white people, yo.
Oh, Charles. I don't think either one of us can pull that off. Welcome to the party, pal. Turn on my car.
Welcome to the party, pal.
Nice.
Thank you.
And Argyle is still on the phone.
Al, you're kind of overreacting here a little bit.
Well, I think he could have just stopped the car.
Al
I love how there's like all kinds of like.
Yeah. Al has gone to the John Landis School of Police Car Driving.
Rubber gloves and wrappers. Oh, William Atherton. Trying to get a table at Wolfgang Puck's restaurant.
Yes, it's true. This man has no dick.
Such a douchebag. Oh, my God.
And everything.
But apparently, according to Rick Genius, he can probably hammer a nail with his penis.
everybody practice your slide.
Never thought I'd love to hear that sound.
Tokyo Drift.
Oh, yeah. LAPD, Tokyo Drift. This is a matter of inconvenient timing.
Now, Mr. Potter. No.
Yeah, exactly. Oh, I didn't get that message, Hans.
Maybe you should put enough bullets aboard.
Wax Tony and Marco. I figured you and Carl and Franco might be a little lonely. Yeah, this is
so. So basically, letting him know that he knows the guys' names.
Yeah, exactly.
It's an old intimidation thing.
Yep. It's a fly in the ointment.
Good
Hans.
Guess.
You want to go for double jeopardy where the scores can really change? Double jeopardy, let's take them.
These are very bad for you.
Late, great Alex Trebek.
The monkey in the wrench.
Fly in the ointment, Hans.
C4.
Pain in the ass. Whoa. All right, plastic explosive. Is extremely volatile.
Yeah. This is where you need Chris Tucker going, like from Rush Hour going, CFO!
CFO! Damn! Here we go. I'm at a loss. You know my name. We're about to... Just another American that saw too many movies as a child.
With his John Wayne. So Roy
that.
Rogers.
I love that one.
I really like the sequined shirts.
Yeah. I love that line, an orphaned orphan child of a bankrupt culture.
Motherfucker.
Yes! There it is.
Told you I had a couple surprises.
Good one. I like that. Oh, here's the journalist that plays by his
yes.
own rules.
Right. We're going to do it live!
Fine, we'll do it live! Eat it, Harvey!
Hi, everybody. I'm Kent Brockman. No.
Hello! Good evening! And I'm Mary Ellen Traynor, and I used to be married to Robert Zemeckis.
Nice. What a little asshole.
He's down in the street. And the other man was Heinrich. But his bag is missing.
Detonators. Boop, boop, boop.
Hunt that little shit down and find me my detonator. There's three down, four to go.
Yeah, Theo's the only one really working at the moment, and you're going to like bust his balls.
Doing anything? Right. Yeah, I really hope that he gets like 100 out of 600 million.
Well, you know, he's got to be skimming off the top, right?
I would hope so.
He has
yeah,
to
boss,
be.
There was only 570 million when I opened
nobody
the
else
balls.
Is
I don't know what
nobody else is watching him do this.
Oh, he's down there by himself. He's doing all the work.
He's got to be skimming off the top.
Seriously. Not right now. Maybe later. Listen fast. This is a party line. And the neighbors got itchy trigger fingers. A party line, for those of you who don't remember.
Yes. Yes.
And actually, Charles, the party line is before you're in my time even.
Yep, but it was kind of the precursor to the 1-900 numbers.
Well, sort of, but party lines were a cheap way to have a telephone, but not necessarily because you didn't have your own phone line. You would have a phone line that you shared with your neighbors because back in the day, the idea of telephones was that you would call and say, hey, Betty, it's Mabel. Would you like to come over to my house for tea and bridge today? Sure. What time? 2 p.m. I'll be there. Bye. Like you would spend like maybe 5 minutes on the phone was the idea of the telephone back in the day. So the idea was you could share the phone with your neighbors, which meant that sometimes you would pick up the phone to make a phone call and somebody would already be on it.
Got it.
Call me Roy.
So this is where we have McClane and Al starting to form a friendship.
Yes, the McClane and Al friendship. Yeah. So you would sometimes listen to. So you know what would happen is people would pick up the phone to make a phone call, and they would realize that their neighbor was on the telephone, and they would still listen in. Like because they'd be saying something like. You know, oh, did you hear that Horace left Mildred for the secretary? You know, there would be 1950s gossip going on. So that was a party line. Back
hello,
in the day.
Dwayne.
Oh, well, here we are.
What do you know?
I know that Barry Manilow probably figured out that you raid his wardrobe. Oh, he claims? Jesus Christ, Powell. I love how everybody's like a really shitty cop except for Powell.
Right. He should be chief and he's just a sergeant at this point.
Well, he shot a kid. That's true. Frankly.
Yeah, that's true. That's why he's on a. It's a miracle he's not even wasn't restricted to a desk job.
Yeah, exactly. He was. He was on his way home.
He's in a police cruiser. So.
But do you remember he says later that he's just a desk jockey that was on his way home?
That's true. He has a uni, so he's a uniform. So.
Yeah. Oh, here we go. She comes in all sassy.
Yep. It's like.
You did. You, when murders you murdered my boss. She's very Princess Leia here,
Yeah.
With the whole, I recognize your foul stench when you were brought on board, kind of a thing.
Exactly. Yeah.
She's very Princess Leia. And he's like, oh, a worthy adversary, finally.
The more you tighten your grip, Hans, the more that Nakatomi Plaza will slip through your fingers.
Will slip through your fingers. Where there's a sofa. Good. No, but I'll have a sofa brought out to you. Good enough? Good enough. Yeah. You got to remember to let your hostages go pee.
Yeah, otherwise you get a big mess. Yeah, it's not pretty.
It's gross.
See, these are the logistics involved of hostage situations. Yeah. So.
And what we've already seen at this party, there's probably enough bodily fluid around this place to...
Right. Especially if the pregnant woman goes into labor.
Seriously. Ms. Gennero.
Yes.
See, she knows. She knows not to play all her cards.
Right.
Charles, have you ever seen the movie Presumed Innocent?
No. That's with... is Jodie Foster in that one?
Harrison Ford and Bonnie Bedelia.
Bonnie Bedelia, okay.
Yeah. Bonnie Bedelia is so fucking amazing in that movie.
Well, she's a good actress. I really like her here.
What she does in that movie, I don't want to try and spoil it for anybody, but what she does in that movie is pure sociopath, and I love it. It's wonderful. Uh-oh.
So our gal just finally got dialed in that there's something wrong.
Yeah.
At Nakatomi Plaza.
Yep. My boss thinks I'm on my way to Vegas. What is Vegas from Los Angeles? Like 3 hours?
Something like that. Sounds about
We're going in.
Got 38 hostages in there.
If there's terrorists in there, where are their demands?
Right.
There's no terrorists. That's why it always weirds me out when somebody talks about Die Hard being about terrorists taking over an office building on
Christmas Eve. Like, no, they're robbers.
Have you ever fucking seen this movie?
Yeah. But see, that's kind of one of the genius things about this is that they're bank robbers posing as terrorists.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. They are exceptional thieves, Charles. Yes. And since they're moving up to kidnapping, we should probably be more polite.
This is true. Al.
Talk to me, Al. What's going on?
You're not eating Twinkies again, are you, Al?
No. Those are for my wife. What are you talking about?
You know when to mind your P's and Q's, Buster. You don't know who you're dealing with.
And when to pray. You are what I think you are.
They're coming in, aren't they?
I told you what kind of people these are, Al. Oh, my gosh. These poor morons.
Smoke them if you got them.
Everybody has to die on Christmas Eve in this movie. It's so sad.
Yep. All right. Not everybody,
Lewis,
though.
Get ready.
The news, you also get ready.
Yeah. No, the only one of these, does anybody survive out of Hans's group except Theo?
I don't think so.
I don't think so either.
I don't think so. Well, let's pay attention, find out.
We'll have to double check, but I think he gets everybody.
I gotta try all the exits. Damn, it's blocked. Yeah.
You know what?
if only I could ram my car through that.
We are in a car.
We are in a car.
Don't be the tin dog, Argyle. Figure it out.
Right. We are in... Nice canine reference.
We are in a car.
Yes.
Yes. Canine reference.
Very good. It's like, I love that he goes down for snacks. He's like...
He's just like Genghis Khan.
He's got a case of the mad munchies, yo.
Yeah, you want a Twinkie Genghis Khan?
Bob Genghis Khan.
I love how they lure Genghis Khan into the phone booth with a Twinkie in Billy's head.
See? Don't underestimate the power of Twinkies.
Dude, we're candy. I mean, I don't care how old you are. That's awesome.
Yes.
I mean, if I'm sitting there waiting for some shit to go down and there's like access to a free Mars bar, I'm fucking taking it.
But see, that's why I love about this movie, because it's realistic.
Yeah.
Like, if you were a guy and you were out there at that position and there's candy right below you, why wouldn't you take it?
Why wouldn't you take it? Yeah, exactly.
It's like you're there robbing the place anyway. You might as well take the candy. Yeah.
Take a few candy. What, is that going to put us over to grand larceny? Shut up.
Yeah. Dun, 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 dun.
Here's my question for John McClane, though. He's got that giant bear, but doesn't he have two kids? Like, is he bringing, like, one present for both of his kids for Christmas? That's kind of shitty.
Yeah, it is.
You know.
Before Christmas.
Christmas.
We went for the Nestle Crunch. Nice choice.
Not a creature was stirring, except...
for the 2x2 formation.
Coming in the rear in standard 2x2 cover formation.
Kick ass.
Kick ass. Yeah, this is, this is not going to end well for really anybody.
No, nope, certainly not these guys.
Yeah.
He's on the second candy bar, by the way.
Yeah, he had a Mars bar and he had a Nestle Crunch bar.
Really? What's your first clue? Lights.
The lights.
Take that, bat signal.
Yeah.
They're going after the lights.
Going after the lights. I would love to see like a short, maybe like 15-minute film of post Die Hard, where you see Deputy Chief Dwayne Robinson.
Send in the car.
Send in the car. Send in the car.
The car.
You see Deputy Chief Dwayne Robinson get, like, demoted for his handling of this situation.
Yeah.
And you see that bitch at 911 totally get fired.
Oh, totally. That would be great.
I would love to see, like, their court cases.
And Al gets promoted above them.
Al gets promoted to everything. Yeah. Police have themselves an RV.
Then you start playing the Tumblr music from Batman Begins. The Molossus. Yeah. The Molossus track.
Yeah. See, I was getting Heinrich confused with one of these guys.
Right.
Like one of the rocket launchers.
See, now
guys.
Look at it. Now look at McLean's shirt. It's completely discolored by now.
I know. He's
filthy. Used to be white, right?
Yeah, he's bloody and he's
sweaty,
and he's been crawling through all kinds of like, get the fuck back.
He was in the air vents. Yeah.
All kinds of air vents and like construction dust.
Yeah.
And stuff. Yeah. This guy in the sweater. That's who I was confusing Heinrich in, because apparently European guys with mullets just all look the same to me, apparently. I don't know. But that's who I was thinking that other guy was, but there's two guys with that same hair, so that's why I was confused.
Yeah. So if you're curious about the swearing in German, Scheiße means shit.
Shit.
And frickin' Z means fuck you.
Yes, it does.
So now you know, and knowing is half the battle.
G.I. Joe.
So, yeah.
See, three years of German class in high school pays off.
Pays off, baby. I love how they, like, try to go up the stairs, but they just get totally screwed up.
They get nailed by, a ground-to-ground missile.
This is what happens.
The quarterback is toast.
And the quarterback is toast. This is what happens when you militarize your police force. And you get fucked.
Defund the police. Defund the police.
Yeah.
Shitty ass desk chair.
Oh, yeah, that's not very ergonomically sound.
No, it's not. But it's 80s ergonomic.
Let's see you take this under advisement, jerkweed. Yeah. Get them out. They're burning in there.
Flame on. Where are the extra crispy?
The itchy eyeballs.
So how's that kicking ass working out for you, Dwayne?
Yeah, it's
C4, he's just like, fuck it. Puts everything in there.
Mayor's going to have my ass.
Like, puts all the detonators in, wraps a, just to weigh it down, takes a computer monitor. Now tell me, for anybody that's worked in an office, haven't you dreamed of this?
It's kind of an
ultimate dream.
That chair in that is going to do some nice shrapnel also.
Right.
Whoa.
Oh, guess what? John's here.
So we get Viggo the Carpathian and the guy who I confused with Heinrich have now been taken
out. Oh, shit!
Maybe back up John McClane from the explosion?
Yeah.
That's probably a good idea. They're using artillery on us!
And suddenly we have a war zone.
Yep, exactly. Welcome to Los Angeles in the 80s.
Yeah.
Nice.
Welcome to the party, pal.
Tracy Reiner there in the background, daughter of Rob Reiner and Penny Marshall.
And probably granddaughter of Carl Reiner.
Yes, and niece of Gary Marshall.
Excellent. No big deal. It just blew up a building. It's cool. It's fun.
It's going to need a coat of paint. Oh, shit. A shitload of screen doors. Is that him?
I don't know who you got 2 weeks of detention.
You know what? 15 years from now, when you've forgotten all about this movie, and this movie's forgotten all about you, and you're wrapped up in the pathetic little life that you have. Be there, man. And I'm going to beat the living shit out of you, okay? I'm going to knock your dick in the dirt.
News for you, Dwayne.
I think anybody's going to take your word over mine. They love me around here. I'm a swell guy. You're a sack of shit, and everybody knows it.
I'm not the one who got butt-fucked on national TV.
Dwayne. You listen to me,
put the other guy back on.
Part of the solution, you're part of the problem. Quit being part of the fucking problem and put the other guy back on.
A little feeling a little underappreciated, Al.
Appreciated, Al.
Partner.
What are you doing?
I know, right? He's like, he probably has drugs in his coat pocket, so he's like doing a couple of bumps. No big deal.
One of those little coke vials.
Yep.
I negotiate million-dollar deals for breakfast. I think I can handle this Euro trash.
Right.
Yeah, I don't Spreckensy talk. Huh? I don't.
Hans, Bobby.
I'm your white knight.
I'm white knight.
Can
I kill this guy, please? No, no, please, don't kill him. Let me do that.
Give me like 10 minutes, and we're gonna fucking kill this asshole.
Yeah, come on, I'm bored here. I've been sitting around all day.
I must have missed 60 minutes. What are you saying?
Right,
you got professional. They're motivated. They're happening, i.e. they want something. See, and here's where we find out that Ellis is fucking racist.
Yeah. Camel jockey.
The heaves, yeah. Northern Ireland. It's none of my business.
Yeah. He's just a winner all around.
Yeah. The heaves, by the way, are Israel. That's Jews.
It's anti-Semitic.
They is a slur meaning Hebrew.
Right. So. Yeah. Camel jockey is being racist for Arabs.
For Arabs, yes.
Yeah.
So, yeah. For
Booby,
those of you
I'm your white knight.
I'm your white knight. I must have missed 60 minutes. Thanks.
Yeah. Don't talk to me. I wanted to kill you.
Poison
but he wouldn't let me.
Yeah. I'm going to shoot you.
Smile.
I'm going to enjoy. Oh, the million-dollar smile. Ellis is a Jamie Lannister kind of character. You just love him because of how much you love him.
Right.
20,000-year-old Twinkie. Oh. What are these things anyway?
Here's the recipe.
Sugar-enriched flour, partially hydrogenated vegetable oil, polysorbate 60, yellow dye number 5.
Everything a body needs.
Grown boy needs. How many kids you got, Al? Does his son ever
sure hope I can like fight with him in a sequel at some point?
That'd be awesome. Yeah, does he show up in one of the sequels?
Yes. Well, Lucy shows up in Live Free or Die Hard, which is the fourth one, and then John McClane Jr. Jack shows up in A Good Day to Die Hard, which we don't talk about.
Okay, see that one I never did see. So
yeah. Everybody's better off just forgetting that one.
Okay.
Jack Courtney played, who is Captain Boomerang in Suicide Squad, played John Jr.
Asshole.
Yeah.
Okay. You're neither shithead. Wasn't Tuvok in Live Free or Die Hard?
I believe he was. Yes. He was. Tim Russ. Yes.
From
Star Trek Voyager. Yeah.
Star Trek Voyager. Ellis? I mean, I gotta hand it to John McClane. Like, if I just met Ellis that night, I would not remember his name.
Right. Well, remember, he's a cop. He's used to trying to remember names.
I guess that's true, yeah. But with all the shit going on, I'd be like, oh, you're that guy that was doing cocaine off of my wife's desk.
Yeah.
Oh, shit.
Ellis, what have you told them?
Told him that we were old friends and you were my guest at the party.
You should be doing this.
Yeah, tell me about it.
Yeah. He's like, the porn in my Coke. I know.
It doesn't even have ice. Like, I mean...
Well, it could have been right out of the vending machine, so it could have been cold.
I don't care, man. If this is going to be the last soda I ever drink, I want a fucking glass of ice with my Coke.
Yeah, but see, I don't want watered-down Coke. I want, like...
He's not going to have that much time to drink it, Charles.
But how ironic that, you know, Coke addict Ellis is drinking Coca-Cola, which used to be made with actual cocaine.
Actual cocaine? Yeah, from the coca leaf.
That's where the name comes from. The shithead does not know what kind of man you are.
But I do. Jesus Christ, Ellis. These people are going to kill you. I honestly don't know, like, if there's anything right now that Ellis could say that would prevent him from being murdered.
No. Nobody is broken up by this killing. Everybody is happy about it.
I like how, like, they're dragging his body away and everybody's just sort of like,
yeah.
Figures.
We saw that. We totally saw that coming.
Yeah, that is not a surprise.
Oh, looks like somebody else got promoted.
You got his private bathroom now, didn't you?
Yep. You get the nice office, corner office. You get the cocaine stash.
Talk to me. Where are my detonators? Where are they, or shall I shoot another one? sooner or later I'll get around to somebody you do care about. Go fuck yourself, Hans.
Just gave him up.
He just let the guy die, man.
You see what's happening here?
Can't you read between the lines? If he gave himself up, they'd both be dead right now. Oh, no way. They'd be talking to us. Oh, yeah, like they really, like anybody.
Right.
Nobody wants to talk to the Los Angeles Police Department, okay? Spoiler alert.
Yeah.
Nobody wants to talk to the Los Angeles Police Department.
And this was back in 88. They didn't want to talk to the LAPD.
Oh, yeah.
Why don't you wake up and smell what you're shoveling?
You're shoveling.
You couldn't drag me away.
Couldn't drag me away.
I got a police car full of Twinkies. I ain't going anywhere.
I'm not going anywhere, man. I'm fine. I'm here till tomorrow. I love Hans Gruber's ridiculous.
Oh yeah, the demands.
List of demands.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes. It's like I've read about it in Forbes or something. I forget what he says.
Time magazine.
Time magazine. That's it. Yeah.
Oh, look at Ellis just sitting there. Hans is the perfect psychopath. Absolutely perfect psychopath.
But you know what I love about him, he's generally very calm about everything.
Oh yeah. Oh yeah.
Liberté and the McClane's just listening to this going, what the fuck?
What the fuck? Asian Dawn Movement? I read about them in Time magazine.
Yeah. It's hilarious.
You know what I've never done, Charles? I've never looked up to see if the Asian Dawn Movement is a real thing.
I don't think it is. I don't recall it ever being a thing, but I could be wrong.
I don't, yeah. Well, it was 1988. I was 12 years old. I wasn't regularly reading Time magazine.
I mean, if nothing else, it's going to be like probably some kind of Japanese porn thing, but we'll find out.
Yeah, you put in Asian Dawn. I do not want to see your Google results.
Holy shit. No. So yeah, it just says Die Hard Wiki fandom, and then
okay,
yeah. Hold on, no, there is something, but it's a Facebook group.
Okay,
news and media website.
Gotcha. We know what their favorite movie is.
Yeah,
hunt that little shit down and find me my detonator.
Yeah, that's all it is. Mostly Die Hard links.
Okay. Gotcha.
So, needless to say, it doesn't exist. I don't know what Time magazine Hans was reading, but yeah, it doesn't exist.
He was reading one of those Time magazines you can get at the fair where you can pay somebody $10 to put your face on the Man of the Year.
Yeah, I was going to say, it must be one of those that has Donald Trump as Man of the Year on the cover.
Yeah, exactly. One of those fake Time magazines that you have to send away for.
Right. The one that he has in Mar-a-Lago.
Oh, God, what an idiot. Here, I'm just a desk jockey who was on his way home.
You're absolutely right.
In my youth.
Hostage, terrorist, hostage. So here we have
the duality.
So kind of like, you know, at RoboCop where they satirize the media.
Yes, very much so.
Yeah, here they are. They're trying to psychoanalyze the terrorists. Yeah.
What's funny about this joke is that
it still goes on today.
Well, the Helsinki syndrome is not a thing. It's Stockholm syndrome.
Yes, yes.
And that actually is Sweden.
Yes. Yeah, Helsinki's in Finland, if I'm not mistaken.
Yeah, it is, yes. But I like that joke. As in Helsinki, Sweden, Finland.
Yeah.
But yeah, Helsinki syndrome isn't a thing, but Stockholm syndrome is.
Right.
And
yeah, where basically a captive becomes sympathetic toward their captor.
Sympathetic and or enamored
right.
with their captive.
And if you need a good reference, go watch the movie The World Is Not Enough.
Oh, geez. Yeah, for sure.
Oh, here's Robert Davi. Speaking of Bond movies.
We'll take it from here.
There's Sanchez himself.
Yep. Oh my God, I can't believe I can't think of his name.
Who?
Jake Fratelli. Jake Fratelli is the name.
Okay.
Yeah. I could think of Francis, but I couldn't think of Jake for some reason.
Yeah. From Goonies? Yeah. The Fratelli brothers.
Yep. Remember we're going to go get your teeth fixed? But we spent the money on Francis's toupee.
With Joey Pants.
Joey Pants. Yeah.
That's what he goes by. Joey Pants.
Joey Pants. Yeah, I first heard that in the commentary for Goonies, because it's all the kids and Richard Donner.
Yeah.
And they refer to him as Joey Pants.
Well, see, I remember it from the Daredevil commentary. Because it's addressed in there as well. Yeah. You know what? Because he was in the 2003 Daredevil with Ben Affleck.
Gotcha.
He was Ben Urich, the reporter.
Oh. Oh, God.
Oh, God.
God, no. Aren't you? You're
one of them. This is a pretty savvy thing that Gruber's doing here.
Yeah, it's pretty savvy.
Pretending to be a hostage.
I would think that McClane would have recognized the voice, frankly.
Well, he used to, you know, trying to throw in that American accent, but yeah.
Which, you should be on fucking TV with that accent. But, he does figure it out pretty quickly. I will say that.
Right.
I managed to get out of there, and...
Yeah, why don't you come this way, you know?
This is where my gun is.
Yeah, exactly. You know, that brief focus on the gun by the camera, then it goes right back to Rickman.
This is just another way of saying, come with me if you want to live.
Yeah.
Not as cool, though.
No, not in the slightest.
I love how he's all, like, beta male, like, immediately the second the FBI shows up.
Yes. Can I help you guys?
You want a breath mint?
You think I'm cool, right?
Hey, guys. We gotta go into the building now.
Can I help you, FBI guys? Two left.
European cigarettes. Thing that dates this movie when John McClane is smoking in the airport.
Right. Yes. Yeah. Obviously, can't do that anymore.
No, can't do that anymore. And you're not one of them. So who are you?
Mr. Cowboy.
See, John.
Oh, did I get that away too soon?
John McClane does a good job here because he's still not playing all of it. He's still not showing all of his cards.
No.
He's not telling him, yeah, my wife.
Yeah.
I'm here to see my wife. She works for this company, blah, 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 blah. He doesn't say any of that stuff.
Yeah. And now Hans knows that he's barefoot.
Hans knows that he's barefoot, which is going to come into play.
Yes, it will. And that's another thing I love about the script is that everything, you know, there's a reason for everything in this movie.
Yeah. Yeah, and here Hans Gruber is now, he's Kaiser Soze-ing John McClane by picking names off of the the letter board.
Bill Clay.
How do you use a handgun, Bill? You know those guns that shoot red paint?
Yeah. You mean like all the red paint that's on my shirt right now?
Heck yeah. Yeah, that's called paintball, Hans. You know,
This is a gun?
This is a gun.
And you gave it to me, you idiot.
You think I'm fucking stupid, hon?
At least he was polite enough to stamp out the cigarette.
Uh-huh.
And McClane's like, I totally saw this coming.
Uh-huh. Problem is, McClane...
Give me my detonators.
You know what the detonator's for, Hans? I already used all the explosives. Or did I? Hans.
Little face-off here.
Why doesn't John McClane just freaking shoot him right in the head right now?
Because it's more dramatic this way.
Well, because we still have... Well, He's got to make sure Holly's okay.
Yeah, we still got like 35 minutes left in the movie.
Yeah, he's got to make sure Holly's okay. Oops.
Oops. Going to count to three. Click. Oops.
Like you did with Takagi?
Click, click.
You think I'm fucking stupid, Hans?
Ding.
You were saying?
That elevator's getting a lot of action tonight. I'm just saying.
The elevator noise is very iconic.
Yeah, it is.
Ding. You got the guy with the
shoot the glass.
Well-styled red hair.
Shoot the glass.
Yeah, there's one other guy here with Carl.
Ooh, there goes those knees. Head right through the glass.
Yeah, so John McClane got him. So now it's only Hans and Carl that are left. So by my count, there's Hans and Carl, Huey Lewis, and Theo.
What about Genghis Khan?
Genghis Khan got it when they had the shootout.
Oh yeah.
When they had the shootout after he ate the candy, he ate a Mars bar and then he met his demise.
That's right. When the FBI or the LAPD moved in.
Yes.
Yeah. Shoot the glass.
The glass. Yeah, this is one of the few scenes in a movie that I can't look at. I have to turn away.
Yeah. It's just very painful to watch.
Because this is a strange story. Yeah. When I was in college, my roommate Steven took a glass blowing class.
Right.
And he came home with all kinds of glass projects. And one night when we were all drinking, somebody knocked something over and broke it. And we thought we picked all the glass up, but we didn't.
Right.
And I one time was trying to sort of scooch myself to sit down in front of a filing cabinet so I could look through files.
Yeah.
And I ran the glass into my heel.
Ouch.
Really far. Like I actually had to go into the bathroom with a pair of scissors and tweezers and pull the skin away so I could get to the glass.
Yeah.
It was bad. And I had to call my teachers the next day at school and say, I can't walk. My foot was kind of swollen and really sore because it was right on my heel. And it was one tiny little shard of glass. This is like a whole thing of glass.
Yeah, I know.
Yeah, this really... Oh, Tracy Reiner has done some good detective work. Just McClane's name, badge number, employment record, vital statistics, family phone.
So basically, she's doxing him.
Pretty much, yeah. Oh, no, Genghis Khan is still alive. Okay,
I thought Genghis
Khan is still alive.
I thought so.
All right, so what happens with... Okay, how does Genghis Khan... Man, that guy looks really pissed.
Only one man could make him that upset. John
Only
McClane.
John could drive somebody that crazy.
Only John can drive somebody that crazy.
I love that.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay.
Yep.
Here we go now.
Oh, shit. There was a broom? No. Are you fucking kidding me?
Better heat up that miracle because you just broke through number six and the electromagnetic came down like a fucking anvil. Yeah, this I can't. Charles, you're going to have to tell me when it's
okay.
Over.
All right.
I can't look at this.
See, this stuff doesn't bother me, so I can do this. I'll take over from here.
It only bothers me because it reminds me of that time when
I understand. I understand you got a past trauma. I get it.
Like shoved in my foot.
I get it. I really do.
Yeah, it just really grosses me out. Oh, God.
He loves me? Joink. He loves me not. Joink.
I mean, and John McClane has lost, probably a pint of blood.
Right. How is he not woozy at this point?
I don't know how he's even walking. Right.
And he keeps smoking those cigarettes, so.
Oh, God. Would you run over your captain's hat with your car? See, okay, I would like all Columbus police
right
to watch this scene
right
and understand that when you accidentally shoot somebody that you shouldn't have shot, you're supposed to fucking feel bad about it and get demoted.
Yeah, pretty much. Or removed from the force. Even better. Yeah, let me focus on this for a while I try to keep from passing out.
So not only am I in horrific pain,
amen.
Not only am I losing blood, so I also feel really, really guilty.
Right.
I think I asked you, are you watching the TV show Big Mouth on Netflix?
You asked me that, but I'm not watching it at the moment.
Okay.
You told me I need to.
Another Harry Potter connection. David Thewlis plays a character called the Shame Wizard.
Right.
And the Shame Wizard comes and makes you feel bad about all the stupid shit you do.
That's funny.
So John McClane is getting a major visit from the Shame Wizard. Okay, well, who's that guy with the goggles? I don't even know who that guy is.
They're just adding guys at random now.
There's just guys.
There's just guys. Extras. Somebody just walked in off the set.
They're like, hey, can I be in your movie? Yeah, why not? Put on this shiny shirt and button it all the way up and you're going to look European.
These are all McTiernan's friends.
Response to a terrorist incident. You ask for miracles, Theo. I give you
the FBI.
Okay, this guy
right
here in the manhole, I forget what his name is.
Oh,
but
I know who you're talking about, yes.
He plays the limo driver that drives Brian Bonsall around in Blank Check, which is one of my favorite kids' movies from the 90s.
Okay.
Have you ever seen Blank Check?
No, I have not.
It stars Brian Bonsall from Star Trek and Family Ties fame.
Right, next
Tone gen. Loke. Tone Loke. And Miguel Ferrer.
Really? That's an interesting. Mm-hmm. Yep. Old Albert Rosenfeld himself.
Yeah, it's an adorable little movie, Joe. Yeah. I think you should watch it. It's on Disney Plus.
I think this guy's first name is Rick, if I'm not mistaken. I think it's Rick Overton.
I think you might be right.
I think it's Rick Overton. I had to think for a minute.
He's who you get when you don't need somebody as shitty as Kurt Fuller.
Yes. If you want somebody less douchey than Kurt Fuller.
Less douchey than Kurt Fuller, you get this guy.
Yeah. Somebody likable. Yeah.
Charles, this is probably my...
Universal Terrorist Playbook.
Yeah. And they're running it step by step. This is probably my second favorite movie
Break out the Beethoven.
Yeah, this is my second favorite movie that has Beethoven's Ninth featured very prominently in it.
Ode to Joy. It's this majestic moment. I love the look, like we're panning, looking up at them with the bright lights and they're smiling.
Merry Christmas. Oh, they're pissing in their pants right now. Mayor's gonna have my ass. And yeah, here
Samurai
we go.
Samurai armor.
Boobies.
Yep.
Degas. So, yeah.
Party man.
Going to party like nobody
can.
Let's broaden our minds.
Lawrence?
Right up the ass.
No, the other one.
I love that.
Yeah.
So the other one.
That's great.
Which is ridiculous because you know what happened. He's like, this is Asian Johnson. So you know that somebody on the other line just said, the black guy?
Right.
Those are bearer bonds, everybody.
And if there's two Asian Johnsons, why aren't you using your first names?
I know, right? And why isn't he the white guy?
You know? Yeah. Yeah. Why is he the white Johnson?
Or the pockmark guy, you know?
Yeah,
he should be like the acne scar guy.
Yeah,
you know?
Yeah, pretty much.
Yeah.
This is why I took Accutane as a kid, by the way.
Oh, yeah, you did, huh?
Yeah, that was, which is probably why I ended up with Crohn's disease. So,
are you fucking kidding me right now? Is that what gave you Crohn's disease?
It's one of the side effects that apparently they stopped making Accutane because of that.
I did not know that that's why they stopped taking it.
It's one of the
so
side effects.
Did you have?
Like, I don't have proof of it. I don't have proof of this, but it seems logical to me.
Oh my god! Did you have like really bad acne, or was it just mildly bad? Or
it was mildly bad.
So obviously not worth it.
Long term, probably not. But
no.
But you know, it's just one of the things that my parents took me to the doctor. They did it, and so I was like, okay. And now, not thinking of the long term effects. What?
Did you get any girls after you took the Accutane?
When I was a senior.
Okay, well that's something, I guess.
yeah. So.
No. Wasn't a total loss.
Yeah, right. Yeah.
All right, so now
the rest of me is a mess, but you know, hey, that's no problem.
So now I'm in the Leinenkugel Snowdrift Vanilla Porter.
Okay. So this is your third of the movie.
It's my third of the movie, my fourth of the evening.
Right. Well, I polished off mine, so I don't have any refills.
Ooh, this is quite good. It's very,
All I have is water now.
Oh, your second drink now?
Who needs that? Yeah. I don't have a second drink. I should have got, I didn't think about a refill.
I have a Sprite Zero I should put in my little ice.
Somebody want to send over the waitress?
Where's my tab?
Yeah, exactly. You hang in there, you hear me?
The fuck were you doing upstairs, Hans? Okay, I would like to say that now I am snacking.
I think you're ahead of me now.
No, I just said it.
Oh, you just... Oh, okay. You just memorized it. Okay. That makes sense.
I memorized.
Okay. I forgot I forgot for a minute who I'm talking to.
Yeah. It's a little bit embarrassing.
No, why? That's awesome. It's like your superpower.
Hey, Charles, if I'm drunk enough to eat in front of you, I'm drunk enough to... To quote this movie in front.
Okay.
So there we go.
Wait.
So
is there some reason you can't eat in front of me?
I have a phobia of eating in public.
I did not know that.
Mm-hmm. Yes, I do.
Really?
So, yeah. That's,
boy, I don't feel so bad about my eating issues.
Yeah. No, I have a. It's part of my eating disorder. I have a phobia of eating in public.
Oh, I'm sorry to hear that.
Welcome to therapy time of drunk cinema, everybody.
Yes. Yeah, exactly. I'm talking about my Crohn's disease, and
yeah, this is therapy. Yeah,
this is where we get personal, kids.
So snack time is now summer sausage and cheese that brought to you by my gracious in-laws who sent us a Swiss Colony House assortment, which is delicious.
Like, was there a Swiss Colony beef log?
Swiss County beef log. I have the garlic beef log right now. That's what I'm doing. So, I figured I should eat that while I'm away from you because I know you don't like garlic.
Oh, and the fact that it's okay because we're teleconferencing this. So
exactly. Oh, you killed my brother.
Prepare to die.
Teacher, what a body. There's a song. Do you know the song "And Then She Bit Me" by DJ Jazzy Jeff and the Fresh Prince?
I don't believe so. How's it go?
It's off of their second record, and it's just nonsense. It's ridiculous. It's so
okay.
funny.
That's funny.
I highly recommend it.
I miss Will Smith being with DJ Jazzy Jeff. I thought that was his best. I preferred him with DJ Jazzy Jeff.
As much as I love the song Nightmare on My Street, because I'm a huge Nightmare on Elm Street fan,
right.
We should do Nightmare on Elm Street, Charles.
We could do that.
We should do that.
We could do that. Add it to the list.
We
talked about Friday the 13th.
As much as I love that song, And Then She Bit Me is my favorite DJ Jazzy Jeff and the Fresh Prince song.
Come home.
Come home. Aw, poor little Lucy McClane.
Right. Say, wait a minute. You're John McClane's wife.
Damn it.
Busted. Your acquaintance.
Busted. Hans Gruber's gun.
See, now I have a bargaining chip.
Let me tell you something about shooting into the air, Charles.
Bullets come down.
They gotta come down sometime.
Now, granted, if you're shooting in a building, they might get stuck up in the tiles, but...
True, but still, it's like... Yeah. I don't know, I wouldn't risk it, because especially with all the stonework and that stupid atrium that they're in.
Boot to the head.
Now, see, we have a ballet dancer here, y'all. This man can freaking move.
We're just flying around for no reason.
You didn't break his neck on purpose, dumbass. That was just dumb luck.
25% of the hostages. I can live with that.
Yeah, if you've ever, you know, wondered why Xan refuses to go in a helicopter.
Right. This
it's
is why.
Shit like this.
Yeah.
Yeah. Helicopters are extremely fragile. I mean, that's what happens to Genghis Khan. He blows up on the roof.
Right.
That's what happens when the roof blows.
Yeah.
Yeah, the other guys that are up here. Yeah, everybody who's not on the roof survives. That's what happens. Okay.
Boo.
Right. Bargaining chip. If you don't know, I have it.
He winged me.
Oh, got him right in the shoulder.
Yep. It's just a flesh wound.
Don't be such a baby.
Walk it off.
All right, so Genghis Khan is up there, but is that guy in the blue button-up shirt up there, too?
Not sure.
Yeah, I'll have to look and see.
You almost kind of have to map this out, where everybody is in this movie.
I know, right?
You need like a whiteboard or something to keep track.
I have to say, this is pretty ingenious
with
to
magnets.
Have this. I love this. Involve your posturing. Draw your little speeches. You're nothing but a common thief.
I'm an exceptional criminal.
I am an exceptional thief, Mrs. McClane. And since I'm moving up to kidnapping, you ought to be more polite.
Savate.
Look at those kicks.
Yep. See, John is street fighting.
Kill ya.
And Carl is trying to do all this, you know, like kung fu.
Doing his balancing here. You know what? That's the thing. It's like it's
chain the fools.
This is not good. This is not good for Carl.
I don't like this, Sarge.
Yeah, tell me about it.
Dwayne, master of the obvious.
Yeah, Dwayne is just like 5 minutes too late with everything.
It's like fucking Saigon.
I was in junior high, dickhead.
I thought that was funny. That was a great line.
One of my favorite lines. And I say that so often.
See, nowadays it would be like, okay, boomer.
Yeah, exactly. Charles, Chris and I are 10 years apart.
Right.
He's 10 years older than me, so.
Yeah.
He graduated college in 1988, and I started the seventh grade in 1988.
Okay.
And so he'll talk about, so Genghis Khan gets shot by McClane.
Uh-huh.
Okay, so now we know that. And so he'll be talking about something he did after college or something in 1989 or something like that. And I'll just say, I was in junior high, dick.
That's funny.
That's one of my favorite lines.
It's like, idiots, you won't go downstairs? Well, here.
Yeah.
Now they think he's a terrorist.
So Genghis Khan was the only one up there because there's no other terrorist up there with him.
Right.
Because the only people that are shooting at him are Agents Johnson.
Yes. Johnson squared. Johnson and Johnson. Yeah, nice.
Yeah. I'll bag this little bastard. Yeah, Nakatomi Plaza.
It's like, run up the stairs, run down the stairs, make your damn mind up already.
Make your damn mind up. So yeah, there's still that guy in the blue shirt. I don't know what happened to him.
I don't know.
I'm assuming.
So why doesn't John just run down the stairs with everybody else?
I don't think he can get to the stairs.
You don't think he can get to the stairs? Okay.
No, I don't think he can get to the stairs. I think he's trying to avoid fire.
Oh, Huey Lewis is concerned.
Huey Lewis? Huey Lewis thinks there's a problem.
I want a new drug, Hans.
There. Yeah. So if there is another guy up there, he's gonna explode.
Please don't let me die.
John, what the fuck are you doing? Please don't let me die. Yeah, because he's got...
There goes the roof.
The Johnsons. And here we have the last shot of the trailer, everybody.
Yep. Red, White, and Boom is a little special this year.
Yeah, exactly. It's much more exciting than usual.
Yeah, pretty much.
Boom. Yeah, he's very, very lucky that it landed the way it landed.
Now, this is a little painful.
Ow!
Because he's kicking on that window with his bloody feet.
Boom.
Which are still bleeding, by the way.
Where is he finding all the clips for this gun? Like, he's been through, like, six clips for this
gun. Well, he kills guys and then he takes their guns.
Well, what are the odds of them having the exact same gun that he had? Isn't that his service revolver still? Well, not his service revolver, but his service gun.
Well, he might have got another gun. I don't know.
I'm losing track of
some of these guys have handguns. Some of these guys have the automatic weapons.
I love this look on his face where he's like, just totally freaked out.
Yeah.
Because that would be me for sure.
Right.
All right, there's another guy there.
This is the best Christmas party ever.
Let's do this again next year. I got to be here for New Year's. See, and now we have Lois Lane's helicopter.
Yep. And Superman, nowhere to be found.
Nowhere to be found. See, he's lucky there's an atrium and a fountain there.
Going to need some more FBI guys. Now the sprinklers kick in.
And we have
ding.
The iconic elevator door.
Yep.
One last time.
Until the elevator blows up. Yes.
I think I would be in those sprinklers and in that fountain, like just taking a bath, like, oh my God.
Well, you need to be soaking his feet, you think.
Yeah.
But he's still got to get Hans. He's a little busy.
This is an act of genius right here with the ambulance.
Right.
Because they can just very, very easily...
But the good thing is it gives Argyle something to do.
I know, Argyle, yeah.
He actually takes out one of the guys. He takes out Theo.
Argyle's one of the heroes of this.
Yeah, he keeps Theo from escaping.
Yeah, and, you know, John McClane is able to, you know, still give his kids that bear.
Yeah. The bear is still standing.
So his magazine is empty.
Yep. But he's got two bullets.
Two bullets in the clip.
Yep. And he's got his handgun. Oh, wait. Packing tape. That'll do it.
MacGyver.
Oh, shit!
Theo's not ready for this. I love that look on Theo's face. Yep. Like, Marr!
And he comes out, rushes right out, and pops him.
Pops him right in the face and just knocks Theo out with one punch.
Yep. Say, I'm the hero of the day.
Yeah, check my ass out. I'd also like to see
there goes the Barabons.
There's Barabons guy. Okay, so he gets knocked in the face.
No, I love this shot right here. With the sparkage and the, you know, the lighting, and he's backlit.
Yeah.
And he's just hobbling. He's hobbling. He's all bloody. He's like, he's been through this entire mess. And Holly's just like, holy crap.
Jesus. So the French guy who had the bearer bonds.
Yeah.
I think McClane just knocked him out.
Yeah, yeah, so, he did. French,
the French guy with the bearer bonds and Theo are the Huey, only two.
And Huey Lewis.
No, Huey Lewis gets shot.
Oh, well, yeah. I thought you were. Yeah. You're jumping ahead, but yeah.
No, I'm talking about who of the.
Yeah, I thought you were talking about who's alive at this point.
No, I'm talking about who of the robbers survives, and it's the French guy with the bearer bonds and Theo, and that's it. Out of 12, only two of them survive.
Yeah.
If you steal 600 million, they will find you unless they think you're already
dead.
Put down the gun.
Let's see, this was very clever of John. He's like, this might happen.
Again, this is mine.
Once again, he's anticipating Hans's reactions here.
He knows the score.
Sunset with Grace Kelly.
All alike. That's Gary Cooper, asshole. Enough jokes. Oh, yes. What was it you said to me earlier?
Yippee-ki-yay, motherfuck.
Motherfucker. I love that Huey Lewis starts laughing and he has no idea why.
I'm just glad to be in this scene.
I'm just hanging out with friends.
Right.
She's like, what do you have planned? Uh-oh. See, yeah, now
Huey Lewis is going.
Happy trails, Hans. Happy trails, of course, being Roy Rogers' big song.
Happy trails to you until we meet again.
So now,
yep.
Foreshadowing like, everyone, like,
yep.
is the watch that we talked so much about at at the beginning of the movie.
Yep.
Now, do we all know the story?
Yep.
That Alan Rickman, how they told him that they were going to drop him like maybe 3 feet, but they actually dropped him 20 feet.
They said they were going to drop him on 3, and they did it on 1.
Uh-huh. So this is a completely genuine reaction.
Right.
He's dropping 20 feet and not expecting
it. I hope that's
it.
Not a hostage.
Yeah. Oh, and we missed it, but when you, when you're watching this.
Thud.
Dunk. When you're watching this in like 4K or super high def, you can see that his gun has a seam on it because it's not real.
Yeah.
It's a rubber gun.
Right.
Okay, that's like not necessarily your blood, John McClane. I don't think I'd kiss anybody with that face right now.
Well, you know, they're caught up in the moment.
Yeah, that's the thing.
And it's nice that, you know, they try to make these bearer bonds that are floating around in the air now look like snow, falling snow.
It's Christmas, Theo.
It's Christmas. Yeah.
Bearer bonds coming down, Christmas. I'm watching it fall.
Let it bond, let it bond, let it bond.
Gonna punch Dick in the face. Baby, please come home. Yeah, it's bearer bonds and all kinds of paperwork because, you know, it's an office building.
Yep. So. Superintendent's gonna be pissed.
We like to take a sample of your brain tissue. Okay.
Yes, have some.
Oh. Oh.
I love that I can make you laugh.
This scene makes me cry. I'm so happy. This is so sweet. And they just look at each other and they just both know them, and Al just nods at him like, yeah, that's me.
Yep.
So touching.
Al, John, Al.
I get choked up at the weirdest movies, Charles. Right.
No, this is good.
This is a good one.
This is a good one. This is the bro moment. Bro hug. Because I mean, John probably wouldn't have gotten through this without Al's motivation.
And yeah, seriously, that's true.
He's the one that, you know, kept him going.
Holly McClane. Well, he's gonna go back to New York after the first of the year. So
right.
I don't know, though. Does Holly Gennero still have a job?
That's a good question. Maybe she transferred to another office.
Yeah, maybe she goes to Tokyo. I don't know. Oh, Carl's still alive, everybody.
It's alive. Oh, not anymore. Al to the rescue.
It's Al was finally able to pull his gun again.
Yep. He's proving his worth.
Somehow they were able to make Gudinov up to look like a crazed Nick Nolte.
And suddenly we got the James Horner soundtrack to Wrath of Khan at this moment.
Hey, I found the will to shoot people again. This is great.
Yes. I have found my true calling once again to kill people.
So seriously, yeah, there's Theo and that French guy. What the hell happened to those guys?
This one's with me.
This one's with me. I don't know how this limo is still driving.
Exactly. Because he just ran it into the van.
And it was sparking. It was sparking 10 minutes ago. Oh. Oh, this is the greatest right here.
Boosh.
Wow.
Did you get that?
Did you get that? Yeah, I hope so. This is their idea of Christmas. I gotta be here for New Year's.
The Die Hard movie that never was.
Yeah.
Oh, it's Vaughn Monroe, everybody. They're outside. It's frightful.
It's frightful.
The fire is so delightful.
Delightful.
And since we know a place to go. Let it snow. Doesn't show a sign of stopping.
Instead, we got a ridiculous Die Hard 2 directed by Rennie Harlan.
Yeah, I kind of like that one.
It's my third favorite
after, obviously Die Hard with a Vengeance. And then I thought I liked it better than Live Free or Die Hard.
No, I like Live Free or Die Hard much better. Wilhelm von Homburg, that is Viggo the Carpathian, everybody.
Okay.
Yep.
Taylor Fry, so apparently plays Lucy McClane. So it's not Mary Elizabeth Winstead.
Gotcha.
I didn't think so. Girl at airport, Terry Lynn Doss, who was a former Playboy centerfold, by the way.
Oh, is that the girl in the leggings?
Well, when she hops up on that guy at the airport.
Yeah, she's got those leggings on. Okay, well, that makes sense.
Yeah, that's her.
Yeah. So, Charles, there's the whole argument about whether or not Die Hard is a Christmas movie.
It's a Christmas movie.
And here's why I think it's a Christmas movie.
Yeah.
Because it takes place on Christmas Eve, and it has a happy ending.
Right.
It's all you need in a Christmas movie.
Right. I mean, think about it. It's like, all those Hallmark movies, all those Hallmark Christmas movies where you have like an estranged couple, they get back together. There's obviously complications along the way that keeping them apart.
It's the woman who goes to the big city to work for the big corporation but realizes she loves the guy from her hometown.
Right.
Yeah. It's basically a Hallmark movie.
It's a Hallmark Christmas movie, yes. Yeah. With exactly. bullets. Yes. And blood.
With bullets and $640 million worth of bearer bonds.
And FBI guys.
And FBI, and well, obviously not a never-ending supply of FBI guys.
We're going to need some more FBI guys.
We're going to need some more FBI guys, sure.
All right, so that's our movie, everybody.
That was Die Hard, y'all.
That was Die Hard. I hope it lived up to the hype.
Merry Christmas, everybody.
Merry Christmas, everybody. Or Happy Hanukkah.
And God bless us, everyone. Yes, it is the last night of Hanukkah.
Yes, it is.
As we are recording this.
So shout out to our mutual friend, DJ Nick.
Yes.
Of the Jewish persuasion. So, yes.
Chag Sameach, everybody.
Exactly. So what's your rating for this one?
Oh, boy. Like I said, I feel like this is the barometer to which all action movies are measured. So I'm going to give this one 9.5 out of 10 stolen Mars bars.
Ooh. So what's the half point deduction?
That asshole at the beginning that makes him look up Holly Gennero's name. So he can just say the only fucking people in this building are on the 30th floor.
Okay. Well, I think it's a perfect movie, personally. I think it's it doesn't get any better as far as an action movie, as far as I'm concerned.
No, that's true. Yeah. So, as an action movie, it's
the gold standard, to use a
gold standard.
See what I did there? Gold standard. Yeah. So I'm giving it 10 out of 10 concealed handguns taped to McClane's back.
Nice. With Christmas backing tape.
Yes. Of course.
Good one.
Thank you. So we don't have any drunk mail this time. No drunk Gmail.
No drunk mail? Okay.
Which I'm kind of surprised, because I thought everybody would be writing in for this one, but no such luck. Yeah. Guys are dropping the ball.
They're doing Christmas stuff.
That's true. That's true. They're busy.
It's Hanukkah. Yep. It's the week before Christmas. You know, people are busy.
People are busy. I get that. All right. But if you want to write to us, if you want to get any thoughts about Die Hard, now that you've listened to us ruin your movie for you, you can write to us at drunkcinemapodcast@gmail.com. That's drunkcinemapodcast@gmail.com.
The Gmail.
Or you can find us on Twitter at drunkcinemacast on Twitter. Or at Drunk Cinema on Facebook. We'd love it if you liked and follow us there. Please share our links, because we're still kind of a brand new podcast. Remember, this is only our third episode.
That's right.
So the more you get us out there, the more we can reach more people and hopefully entertain more people in the process. So we'd love it if you did that. So spread the word, my people. And Xan, in the meantime, where can they reach you?
Well, I'm on Facebook as Xan Sprouse, and on the Twitter machine and the Instagrams as Udinax19. And if you want to hear me talk about David Lynch related things with you, Charles, everybody can tune in to us at Ghosts with the Twin Peaks podcast. And if you want to hear me a little bit more coherently discussing good movies, you can listen to me.
You're pretty coherent tonight, by the way.
Yeah, listen to me.
Must have been all that cheese that you ate.
It must have been the cheese, yeah. The aforementioned DJ Nick and Rachel Friend on Gold Standard, the Oscars podcast.
Yep. Please check those out. And DJ Nick and Xan were kind enough to have me on to talk Star Wars with them recently. So
that's right.
I really appreciated that. I had a lot of fun talking about my all-time favorite movie. So that was great. And hope to do that again sometime soon.
That was a good time.
It was good times, good times. And as for me, of course, at Charles Skaggs on Twitter, at Charles Skaggs on Facebook, and at Charles Skaggs on Instagram, and my blog at Geeky Things.
Damn good coffee. And hot.
Damn good coffee and hot, where I talk about all the stuff we talk about here on Drunk Cinema. So things like Batman or Ferris or Die Hard or all kinds of comic book sci-fi news. News of my other podcasts for Southgate Media, including Titan Talk, the Titans podcast, where DJ Nick and Jesse Jackson and I, we talk Titans and Doom Patrol, but those are on hiatus at the moment. We're waiting for those to come back. But in the meantime, you can listen to our podcast. Check that out. Or the Fandom Zone podcast that right now I'm also doing with Nick and Jesse, where we just finished talking the 1990 Flash pilot for our 199th episode and had a lot of fun with that.
So awesome.
And I got a like from John Wesley Shipp on Twitter.
That is amazing.
Which is awesome, because I tagged him on our when I posted our links, and he liked it. So I thought that was sweet.
That is fantastic.
It's like, what better than the Flash himself, right?
So what more proof do you need of how awesome this podcast is?
Yeah, exactly. So what more could anyone ask?
So, 200 feet below.
So next time we're going to be on this coming Sunday, we are going to be talking our 200th episode of the Fandom Zone.
That's amazing.
Since we already talked the 1990 Flash pilot, well, hey, why don't we talk the 2014 Flash pilot for our 200th episode? And we'll probably be like contrasting and comparing the two pilots and try to, you know, get a feel for how things changed, what lessons the 2014 version learned from the 1990 version, and so on. So I hope everybody checks that out. I think it'd be a really good discussion. And what else? Oh, yeah, Next Stop Everywhere, the Doctor Who podcast that I do with Jesse Jackson and assorted special guest companions, like a certain Xan Sprouse, who frequents us from time to time.
On occasion.
On occasion, is welcome whenever she damn well wants, as far as I'm concerned. And then, you know, we talk all things Doctor Who, Torchwood, Sarah Jane Adventures, Big Finish Audios, and more. Then, like Xan said, our wonderful Ghost with the Twin Peaks podcast, where we talk all things Twin Peaks, David Lynch. And coming up at the beginning of the new year, we're going to be talking the 1984 version of Dune at long last. I'm really looking forward to that.
Yeah, baby.
So that'll be fun to look. So look forward to that in January.
It's the best thing Toto ever did. That's for goddamn sure.
Pretty much, yeah. I love that soundtrack. Yeah. I really do.
I love that soundtrack.
That's great. So everybody check that out. And next time on Drunk Cinema, well, you know, this is our last show for 2020, as we're more than eager to get rid of 2020.
Hell yeah.
And we kind of break for the holidays because we got things to do just like you guys.
Yep.
So, but we'll be back in January for our fourth episode, The Adventures of Buckaroo Banzai Across the Eighth Dimension.
The Eighth Dimension.
Yes. The 1984 classic, I believe.
Yeah, 1984.
1984, starring, of course, Peter Weller and John Lithgow and all kinds of great people.
It's Lithgow, by the way.
Is it Lithgow? I thought it was Lithgow. All right.
I remember him saying corrected. That on... He talked about that with Bob Costas on Later with Bob Costas in the mid-90s.
Okay.
And I thought I'd never... Yeah, but yeah, so it's Lithgow.
Yeah, this is...
Yes, John Lithgow, Dan Hedaya, Christopher Lloyd, Ellen Barkin...
Jeff Goldblum. Right. Maybe you heard Clancy Brown. This is the first.
Yeah.
This is my first introduction to Clancy Brown.
Exactly.
Before he became Lex Luthor on Superman the Animated Series.
Exactly. And years before he was playing LBJ in The Crown.
Right.
And Charles, did you see the film adaptation of Stephen King's Doctor Sleep?
Yes, I have.
Carl Lumley.
Yes, who played the Martian Manhunter and also was in Buckaroo Banzai.
Buckaroo Banzai, he plays the Scatman Crothers character. He plays Dick Halloran in the film version of Dr.
Yeah.
Sleep.
Yeah, who in the Buckaroo Banzai, he plays John Worfen, if I recall correctly.
No, that's John Lithgow. He's John Parker.
John Parker, that's
in
right. You're
Buckaroo
right.
Banzai.
Yeah, right.
Yeah.
I defer to your expertise.
Yeah, Buckaroo Banzai, all the aliens are named John.
Yes. It's great.
Yeah.
You got John Bigbute.
John Nolan, John O'Connor, John Smallberries,
right.
John Littlejohn.
So, yeah, this is obviously a very big cult classic film from 1984. A lot of fun.
Yep.
Great theme at the end where they're all walking.
Oh, my gosh.
I love the Buckaroo Banzai theme.
Yeah.
I love that. So
Michael, the theme is by a composer named Michael Boddicker.
Yes.
And which I always thought was interesting because his name is Michael Boddicker. And then Peter Weller went on to be in RoboCop, where his nemesis is named Clarence Boddicker.
Right.
Yeah. So.
Interesting.
It's interesting that, like, Boddicker is not a name you hear very often, but Peter Weller has been in two movies where somebody named Boddicker is featured prominently.
There you go. See, these are things you learn here in Drunk Cinema.
This is the stuff you learn. And I have two movies that I consider my favorite movie, Charles, and Buckaroo Banzai is one of them. So
excellent. So I'm guessing this will probably be a very high rating from Xan.
This is a very high rating from Xan, yes, for sure.
And this will be a high rating from yours truly, spoilers. But
yeah, spoiler alert.
Yeah.
So yeah.
So it's going to be a lot of fun. So everybody, yes, please come on back. Xan, thank you so much for this. I had a ball talking Die Hard with you. This is a lot of fun.
Thank you so much, Charles. This is a great way to spend our quarantined Christmas.
Right, exactly. Yeah. If we can't hang out together, at least we can do this, right?
Exactly. Exactly. Yeah.
Yeah.
We at least, you know, at least we have Die Hard on Skype together. It's at least something, right?
Yeah. If Skype will hold up for, would not keep delaying like it's been. Yeah. So guys, thank you so much, you know, for listening. We really appreciate you guys listening to us. Hope you enjoyed it. Oh, and before we sign off, I do want to give a special shout out to Christine Peruski, who was really eager to talk Die Hard. With the way things are going and our schedules, it didn't work out.
I apologize, Christine. It was just a little too chaotic this week.
Yeah, don't think that we didn't forget you, but just it was a lot simpler to do it this way. So we'll get you in there eventually.
But Christine, to make a long story short, too late. We are planning something for you.
Oh, yeah. All right. So that's good news. So stay tuned. All right. So everybody, like I said, thanks for listening. Come on back. Episode 4, The Adventures of Buckaroo Banzai Across the Eighth Dimension. I don't have to say any more than that, do I?
No, you really don't.
It's one of Xan's favorite movies, certainly one of mine as well. And then we'll see you next time right here on Drunk Cinema. Bye, everybody.
Bye, everybody. Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.
Happy New Year. Happy Hanukkah. Kiss my ass. Kiss his ass.
Yippee-ki-yay, motherfucker.
Oh, the weather outside is frightful, but the fire is so delightful. And since we've no place to go, let it snow, let it snow, let it snow. It doesn't show signs of stopping, and I brought some corn for popping. The lights are turned way down low. Let it snow, let it snow, let it snow. When we finally kiss goodnight, how I hate going out in the storm. But if you really hold me tight, all the way home I'll be warm. The fire is slowly dying, and my dear, we're still goodbying. But as long as you love me so, let it snow, let it snow, let it snow. When we finally kiss goodnight, how I hate going out in the storm. But if you really hold me tight, all the way home I'll be warm. The fire is slowly dying, and my dear, we're still goodbying. But as long as you love me so, let it snow, let it snow.